Sehr geehrte Damen und Herren, liebe ZuschauerInnen am Stream, wir feiern heute den 200. Geburtstag von Rudolf Clausius, ein Forscher, Hochschullehrer und Rektor der Uni Bonn. Clausius hat Beiträge zur Forschung geliefert, die die Welt verändert haben. Stichwort Entropie. Mein Name ist Barbara Kirchner, ich bin Professorin für theoretische Chemie an der Uni Bonn und ich werde Sie heute durch den Abend führen. Wie Sie bereits gesehen haben, haben wir ein sehr spannendes, aber auch umfangreiches Programm und deswegen möchte ich unsere Ehrengäste und Redner einzeln begrüßen. Magnifizenz, Spektabilitäten, liebe Oberbürgermeisterin Dörner, liebe Nobelpreisträger Jean-Marie Len und Stephen Chu, lieber Professor Meschede, lieber Professor Orfall, lieber Professor Peter Föhringer, liebe Frau Professorin Ulrike Thoma und liebe Frau Dr. Westernströer vom transdisziplinären Research Area MATTER. Ich heiße Sie herzlich willkommen. Ich wünsche nun allen Gästen eine gute Unterhaltung und ich bitte Rektor Hoch zur Bühne, denn er wird diese Feier eröffnen.
Liebe Frau Professor Kirchner, herzlichen Dank für die schöne Einleitung. Dear Lord Mayor Dörner, dear Professors Len and Chu, dear colleagues, students, distinguished guests from Bonn and abroad, live here in the Wolfgang Paul Lecture Hall and in the live stream, ladies and gentlemen, it is my great pleasure to welcome you today to our celebration act of the bicentennial birthday of Rudolf Clausius, professor and rector at the University of Bonn, and undoubtedly one of the most brilliant minds of the 19th century. It was Clausius who discovered the second law of thermodynamics and invented the concept of entropy. You will hear more about it in the talks later. Today, we would like to honor this outstanding thinker and visionary whose work continues to radiate far beyond his own discipline with this celebration ceremony. And I'm very glad, and we are very honored, to welcome two Nobel laureates, Professor Jean-Marie Len, Nobel laureate in chemistry, and Professor Stephen Chu, Nobel laureate in physics, to celebrate Clausius and his groundbreaking discoveries at the interface between physics and chemistry together with us. Dear Professor Len, dear Professor Chu, a warm welcome again. We are very much looking forward to learn about your views of the significance and influence of Clausius' work until today. 100 years ago, on June 24, 1922, physical chemist and Nobel Prize winner Walter Nernst, the discoverer of the Nernst heat theorem, the Nernst distribution law, and several other fundamental findings, gave a speech honoring the 100th birthday of Rudolf Clausius. Of course, I'm very pleased that today, celebrating the 200th birthday of Clausius, we have two Nobel Prize winners as speakers. And I'm sure that our university archivist, Dr. Becker, will integrate this into the annals of the university history. Thank you again for being with us today. So Clausius began his work at our university upon his appointment as professor of physics and director of the Institute of Physics in 1869, and continued this work for 2 decades until his death in the year 1888. You will hear more about a detailed description of his work later in the talk of Professor Meschede. The 19th century was in general a very influential time period in science history. Charles Darwin published On the Origin of Species in 1859. Louis Pasteur produced the first vaccines against rabies and anthrax. By the way, both of these scientists were awarded honorary doctorates of the University of Bonn on the occasion of the 50th birthday of the university in 1868. And it was, of course, also a golden age of natural sciences also at our university. Many renowned scholars were recruited. New disciplines emerged in natural sciences, and new institutes were founded. Among them, for example, the world's largest chemistry building at that time, of which the chemist August Kekulé became the director. Kekulé, maybe one of the most famous chemists at all time, I would say, had discovered the ring structure of benzene in 1865. Kekulé's institute was called by his contemporaries Temple of Science. He and his assistants not only had their laboratories in the institute, but they also lived there. As the institute's director, Kekulé had 11 private rooms with kitchen and bath, and also a 2-floor ballroom for parties, right, I guess. Other prominent scholars at the university at that time were, for example, Hermann Helmholtz, Heinrich Hertz, Friedrich Wilhelm August Argelander, and in chemistry, Justus Liebig, Otto Wallach, and also Emil Fischer spent some time here. Both were assistant with Kekulé's, and many more. Bonn became a world-renowned center for physics and chemistry thanks to these colleagues at that time. Clausius, on the other hand, did not have his own institute building. His Institute of Physics was integrated into the main building of the university, the castle, which this morning you have visited. After Kekulé's Temple of the Sciences was finished, Clausius had to struggle to get funding for adequate space and equipment. Finally, he obtained new accommodation in the Buen Retiro building, the west wing of the castle, after the surgical clinic moved out. Like Kekulé, Clausius was allowed to take residence in his institute. What a relief for him. This meant that Clausius no longer had to walk to his workplace. Walking was difficult for him because he had a knee problem, presumably due to his wounds from the Franco-German War, 1870-71. As a dedicated and renowned scientist, Rudolf Clausius was eventually also elected rector of the university in 1884-85 for 2 semesters. He was the 68th rector of the University of Bonn. By the way, I'm the 143rd rector of the university. Now, becoming rector, being elected as rector, happened to many distinguished scientists in Bonn. Kekulé, for example, was also elected rector in 1877-78, and many other scholars too. Clausius probably did not expect too much administrative work that would have kept him away from his research as a rector. As rector of the university, he presided over the Senate. There, however, his task was rather to inform the university about the guidelines and the requirements of the Prussian Ministry of Culture and the government. The Prussian Ministry of Culture was not only responsible for the supervision, but also for the general management of the university. The rector was not even allowed to see the university's finances. These times have changed. God's sake, yes. Drastically, I would even say. Nowadays, rectors in most cases have to make a very tough decision to leave science when they take office. Universities in our state, North Rhine-Westphalia, are mostly autonomous, with all the implications for research, teaching, administration. But comfortingly, the rectors are also supported by great teams, foremost by the provost, the vice rectors, the deans, and you, the colleagues and the students. Ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to close to thank again our distinguished guests, Professor Lehn and Professor Chu. I'd like to thank Professor Kirchner, who will introduce the two Nobel laureates later. And I'd like to particularly thank my colleagues, Professor Dieter Meschede, Professor Peter Föhringer, and also our guest from the Karlsruhe Institute of Technology, Professor Orphal. It is you, the three of you, with your sparkling enthusiasm, who have inspired me, the Vice Rector for Research, Andreas Zimmer, the two of us, right, and of course the entire rectorate, to carry out and host this ceremony in memory of Rudolf Clausius. And it was Peter Föhringer and Frau Professor Thoma, Ulrike Thoma, who have inspired the university to dedicate a new professorship, the so-called Clausius Professorship, to an outstanding scientist at the interface between chemistry and physics, in memory of the great scholar Rudolf Clausius. I thought I could mention the name of the person who is in the audience, but I'm not allowed to do so because the recruiting procedure is not finished yet, right? And some legal aspects prevent me from doing this. But the person I mean who has accepted the call is in the public, and a warm welcome to you, you know, whose name I cannot mention. Yes. Yeah. And now, let me, a big thank you also to the colleagues of the Institute of Physical Chemistry for renaming their institute in Clausius Institute for Physical and Theoretical Chemistry. We had a very nice celebration a couple of minutes ago, and Peter, you have given a fantastic speech. Thank you very much for this. Ladies and gentlemen, Clausius also was a pioneer of sustainability. He knew about the finite nature of our resources, which are all still the basic foundations for our technical and industrial civilization. A great visionary. You will hear more about this in the presentation of Professor Meschede in a couple of minutes. And with that, I'd like to thank you again for being here, and I'd like to give the floor to our Lord Mayor of the Federal City of Bonn, Katja Dörner. Thank you very much.
Magnifizenz, sehr geehrte Ehrengäste, Ladies and Gentlemen, ich freue mich sehr, heute persönlich die Glückwünsche der Bundesstadt Bonn zum 200. Geburtstag des Bonner Physikers Rudolf Clausius übermitteln zu können. On this fine occasion, I would like to extend a particularly warm welcome to the 1987 Nobel Laureate in Chemistry, Professor Dr. Jean-Marie Lehn, and the 1997 Nobel Laureate in Physics, Professor Dr. Stephen Chu. Welcome to Bonn and welcome to this very special and outstanding anniversary evening. Als Oberbürgermeisterin habe ich das Privileg, sehr viel unterwegs zu sein, auch in der eigenen Stadt und immer viel zu erfahren und auch lernen zu können. Und ich wusste zwar, dass Rudolf Clausius zu den berühmtesten Physikern Europas im 19. Jahrhundert gehörte. Ich habe aber in der Vorbereitung auf heute Abend auch sehr viel Neues gelernt. Unter anderem, dass er nicht nur der Entdecker des zweiten Hauptsatzes der Thermodynamik, sondern auch der Begründer der kinetischen Gastheorie ist, dass seine Forschungen viele Theoretiker wie beispielsweise Max Planck und Albert Einstein inspiriert haben und unter anderem auch zur Entwicklung der Quantentheorie geführt haben. Clausius ist Schöpfer der Begriffe Enthalpie und Entropie, die charakteristisch für das Klimageschehen sind, weswegen man Clausius auch als Wegbereiter der modernen Klimaforschung bezeichnen kann. Er war tatsächlich, wir haben es schon gehört, ein Vordenker im Bereich Nachhaltigkeit, der schon vor 200 Jahren angemahnt hat, dass wir rücksichtsvoll mit unseren natürlichen Lebensgrundlagen und natürlichen Ressourcen umgehen müssen, insbesondere auch mit fossilen Brennstoffen. Und aktueller kann man ja eigentlich in der aktuellen Situation gar nicht sein. Und damit ist eben auch Bonn, die Stadt der Nachhaltigkeit, genau der richtige Ort, wo Clausius gewürdigt wird und wo wir diesen wunderbaren Festakt begehen. Die Wissenschaftsregion Bonn ist ein international höchst angesehener Standort, der bereits zahlreiche bekannte Forschungspersönlichkeiten hervorgebracht hat oder sie auf ihrem Weg begleitet hat. Dazu gehören beispielsweise die Nobelpreisträger Professor Wolfgang Paul, dessen Medaille ich persönlich vor einigen Jahren mal anschauen und mit meinen eigenen Händen berühren durfte. Ich werde das nicht näher ausführen, aber wenn wir uns bei einer Gelegenheit mal zu einem Glas Wein treffen, kann ich da gerne drüber erzählen. Das war ein ganz, ganz besonderes Ereignis für mich damals als Studierende und hat mich sehr geprägt und mich auch motiviert, mich mit der Forschung von Herrn Professor Paul auch auseinanderzusetzen, auch wenn ich einen literaturwissenschaftlichen und einen Politikwissenschaftler Hintergrund habe. Nobelpreisträger Wolfgang Paul, Professor Reinhard Selten, Professor Reinhard Genzel, Professor Otto Wallach, eine große Anzahl von exzellenten Wissenschaftlerinnen und Wissenschaftlern hat unsere Universität hervorgebracht. Ich möchte auch ganz besonders nennen die beiden einzigen deutschen Preisträger der Fields-Medaille, des sogenannten Nobelpreises der Mathematik, die beide aus Bonn kommen, Professor Gerd Faltings und Professor Peter Scholze, die beide aktuell am Max-Planck-Institut für Mathematik bzw. am Hausdorff-Zentrum für Mathematik an der Universität Bonn forschen. Weitere 5 Nobelpreisträger haben als Studierende, Mitarbeitende oder Professoren einen Bezug zur Universität Bonn, ihre Auszeichnungen tatsächlich aber erst später bekommen. Dazu gehört auch Professor Otto Wallach, der unter Professor August Kekulé nach Bonn kam und hier 17 Jahre geforscht hat, und Professor Philipp Lennart, der in Bonn an Kathodenstrahlung forschte und dafür einige Jahre später ebenfalls den Nobelpreis verliehen bekam. Ein sehr bekannter Alumnus unserer Universität ist Professor Reinhard Genzel, der 2020 gemeinsam mit der US-amerikanischen Astronomin Andrea Shee den Nobelpreis für Physik für die Entdeckung des supermassenreichen Schwarzen Lochs im Zentrum der Milchstraße erhielt. Was mir natürlich auch aufgefallen ist bei der Vorbereitung und Ihnen sicher auch schon beim Vortrag, den einführenden Worten von Herrn Professor Hoch und den Namen, die ich erwähnt habe, doch ein eklatanter Mangel an Frauen. Wir können uns das alle sehr gut erklären, warum das so ist. Und ich habe mich sehr gefreut, eben bei der Nennung der Ehrengäste dann auch einige Professorinnen vernehmen zu dürfen und hier viele Studierende, Wissenschaftlerinnen, Forscherinnen zu sehen. Wir haben eben schon darüber gesprochen, Herr Professor Hoch und ich, dass unsere Alma Mater, unsere Universität das sehr im Blick hat und daran arbeitet und ich glaube, das ist auch sehr wichtig. Die Nobelpreisträger, die ich eben genannt habe, sind alle eng mit der Universität verbunden. Sie zeigen, dass sich die Exzellenz der Universität seit jeher durch die Geschichte der Universität zieht. Dabei haben sie, wie Rudolf Clausius, wichtige Fundamente für grundlegende Entdeckungen gelegt und zentrale Veränderungen und Erkenntnisse in der Wissenschaft durch die Forschung in Bonn bewirkt. Wir Bonnerinnen und Bonner, wir können stolz sein auf unsere Universität und wir sind das auch. Sie gehört als Exzellenzuniversität zu den ganz forschungsstarken, zu den forschungsstärksten Universitäten Europas. Sie ist bekannt für ihre international vernetzte Spitzenforschung, der eine kollaborative, innovative und internationale Forschungskultur zugrunde liegt. Sie hat 6 Exzellenzcluster, zahlreiche BMBF- und DFG-Forschungsverbünde und arbeitet eng im Rahmen von EU-Forschungsvorhaben mit internationalen Partnern zusammen. Zahlreiche Wissenschaftspreise wie Leibniz-Preise und auch Humboldt-Professuren bestätigen diese Forschungsstärke, die eben auch, und da komme ich wieder zum Anlass des heutigen Abends, eben auch Herr Clausius schon ausgezeichnet hat. Als Oberbürgermeisterin freue ich mich weiterhin auf eine gute und erfolgreiche Forschung an der Universität Bonn. Ich werde leider heute Abend nicht ganz so lange dabei sein können. Auch das gehört zum Job der Oberbürgermeisterin, dass man viel unterwegs ist. Ich wünsche Ihnen eine wunderbare Veranstaltung. Ich bin mir ganz sicher, dass die Vorträge, die Sie heute Abend hier hören können, extrem interessant sind und Sie sicherlich auch in Ihrem persönlichen Bestreben weiterbringen werden. Einen wunderbaren Abend, eine schöne Feier wünsche ich Ihnen und ganz herzlichen Dank für Ihre Aufmerksamkeit.
Liebe Frau Oberbürgermeisterin Dörner, herzlichen Dank für Ihren Redebeitrag und für Ihre Grüße zu unserer Festveranstaltung. Ich komme jetzt zum nächsten Punkt unseres Programmes. Wir haben uns überlegt, dass es vielleicht gut wäre, nochmals zu resümieren, wer Rudolf Clausius eigentlich ist. Und zu diesem Zweck hat der Kollege Dieter Meschede, einen kleinen Vortrag vorbereitet, in dem er uns zeigt, warum Clausius von Bedeutung ist. Zu Peter Meschede möchte ich ganz kurz sagen, er hat Physik studiert in Köln bis zum Diplom, dann ist er nach München gegangen an die LMU und die hat er mit der Habilitation verlassen nach Amerika, wo er dann in Yale wirkte, um dann kurz darauf nach Garching zurückzukommen und in Hannover eine weitere Professur anzunehmen, bevor er dann nach Bonn zu uns gekommen ist. Seine Arbeitsgebiete sind Quantenoptik, die Quanteninformationsverarbeitung und die Präzisionsspektroskopie. Und wie Sie gleich sehen werden, hat er noch weitere Begabungen, aber er hat noch eine ganz besondere Begabung. Er ist ein begnadeter Redner und Lehrer. Und wir freuen uns, dass er nun uns noch einmal kurz vorstellt, warum Clausius so wichtig ist. Lieber nicht Peter, sondern Dieter Meschede.
Dankeschön, das mit dem begnadeten Redner warten wir mal ab. Magnifizenz, lieber Michael, Frau Oberbürgermeisterin, dear Steve, dear Jean-Marie, verehrte Festversammlung hier und am Livestream. It is really a very big honor for me to share with you some aspects of the life and work by Rudolf Clausius, professor at our university from 1869 to 1888. In fact, the rector already mentioned this, we celebrate Rudolf Clausius every 100 years. And imagine the beautiful date in 200 years from now, and maybe then we have 4 Nobel Prize winners coming or so, yeah? My grand challenge is they gave me not more than 10 minutes to share with you the entire life and work of Rudolf Clausius, but I will try to transfer a bit of the fire that was ignited In my mind, especially by my dear colleagues Peter Föhringer and Johannes Orphal over the past years. Rudolf Clausius was born in Köslin by the Baltic Sea, which is today a part of Poland, a Prussian citizen and the son of a Protestant pastor. Already as a student in gymnasium, he developed deep interest in science and technology, as indicated by this meticulous, I think, drawing of a steam engine around 1839. The original actually will be on display in Dr. Becker's exhibition at the University Museum for another 3 months. Clausius enrolled in 1840 at the young Friedrich Wilhelms Universität, not Bonn, Berlin, today Humboldt University, where he worked with the famous mathematician Dirichlet. And he studied by himself to a large extent the works by Fourier, Laplace, Poisson, Gauss, and others, so a deep bias for mathematical physics. However, Clausius remained keenly interested in experimental and technical aspects of his profession throughout his life. In fact, as a professor of physics at the newly founded ETH Zürich in the late 1850s, then called the Eidgenössisches Polytechnikum, he taught courses on technical physics as well on the theory of steam engine. Interestingly enough, only an additional appointment at the University of Zurich allowed him to award a doctoral degree, since technical institutions all the way up to the end of the 19th century were not regarded on par with real universities. His students, by the way, included Konrad Röntgen and Karl von Linde. His studies at Berlin fostered friendship with his contemporaries in science, especially the one-year older Hermann Helmholtz. Imagine Helmholtz and Clausius sharing student lunch at the Mensa. Or more importantly, Gustav Magnus, another physicist, gathering them and other young physicists at his home in downtown Berlin to discuss science, which was new at that time, and which, by the way, initiated the Deutsche Physikalische Gesellschaft as the oldest expert society in the world in 1845. Why is this important? Because it sharpened Clausius' interest in heat transformations. By reporting on the work by Clapeyron, Carnot, and Joule to his fellows. Today, most physicists have at least heard, maybe not understood, the Clausius-Clapeyron equation. In crude words, it describes one of the most quoted terms and names in the IPCC report on climate affairs, because it describes the amount of water vapor in the atmosphere. Let us follow the thinking of Clausius a bit more closely. Look at this. I have to go here. So, look, it's hot. So, please try to see it from even the distance. So, have a look at my little heat engine here. Yeah, this heat engine converts the hot water of your coffee in the mug below into mechanical rotation, obviously. And all it takes is to have the warm reservoir on the bottom and to have the cool reservoir on the other side. And that is all that you need to make a machine working. There is an air piston which is periodically cooled and heated so that it expands and makes the thing work. Okay, so obviously this is connected to the original drawing I showed you already. Yeah. So indeed, heat engines contributed to two towering scientific breakthroughs between roughly 1845 and 1865, and with Clausius, one of the key players. Number one, energy conservation, the first law of thermodynamics. I believe, I hope, there is nobody in the audience who does first not know it and doubt it or so. So that seems clear. However, by 1850, not even the word energy was around. Most people do not know this. It was Helmholtz who, in his famous Abhandlung, which in English means treatise, über die Erhaltung der Kraft, on the conservation of force, introduced this fundamental and far-reaching principle in 1847, not only for physics. And it was Clausius whose virtuosity cast it into rigorous mathematical terms and made him famous immediately as one of the internationally leading thermodynamicists of his time. But Clausius remained dissatisfied with the physical understanding of heat engine Why would it be possible to fully convert mechanical energy into heat by friction? You know this from your car, but not vice versa, heat energy into mechanical energy. The toy heat engine I showed you transforms indeed heat energy into mechanical rotation. But on the cool side, it also disposes and loses lots of heat energy Wouldn't it be nice to use our cars, for instance, with the only energetic effect that it would drive at the expense of cooling the atmosphere? This would make a perfect recycling economy. No, it's not possible. And it was Clausius and in the United Kingdom, William Thomson, the later Lord Kelvin, who systematically phrased the second law of thermodynamics. It says, it is impossible to operate a car with the only effect of cooling down the atmosphere. Even simpler, but equivalent, a warm body cannot spontaneously get warmer at the expense of another one getting cooler. You surely have never observed that. So it's a phenomenological but very deep statement. But Clausius thought how to cast this phenomenological statement into mathematical terms. I'm not going to come with formulas now. Amazingly enough, Clausius realized first by purely mathematical means that in engines, heat played a different physical role than mechanical work, albeit both of them are forms of energy. Yeah? It took him himself also more than a decade to come to terms with his own ideas and then introduce what he is perhaps most famous for, the invention and the role of entropy, for which he used the letter S, capital S, which is in use till today. By the way, also most of the other quantities we use and teach today are the symbols that Clausius introduced. He describes entropy as, in the first place, the transformation content of the body, probably very abstract. His thoughts with respect to thermal physics culminated in 1865 in a beautiful article über verschiedene für die Anwendungen bequeme Formen der Hauptgleichung der mechanischen Wärmetheorie. Muss man sich auf der Zunge zergehen lassen etwas, ja? On various for applications convenient forms of the main theorems of heat theory. In his article, he outlines what we may consider, in the words of Albert Einstein from 1949, the only general physical theory which, within the applicability of its fundamental terms, will never be overturned. The article begins with Clausius explicitly accommodating Lord Kelvin's term energy for the German language. In 1865, the word Energie was introduced into the German language by an article. Energie, and especially just as a matter of convenience to replace the ambiguous word Kraft. For what comes next in this article, I cannot resist to quote Clausius himself. If one is looking for a descriptive name for S, so that it can be applied unchanged in all the new languages, I propose to call the quantity S after the Greek word entropē, transformation, the entropy of the body. I have intentionally formed the word entropy as similar as possible to the word energy. And then listen to the last paragraph. One can express the fundamental laws of the universe corresponding to the true laws of the mechanical theory of heat in the following way. One, the energy of the universe is constant. Two, the entropy of the universe strives towards a maximum. I think this is an announcement like a drumbeat or so. And it is not a footnote to say this entropy also defines the physical era of time. Heat flows from a warmer to a cooler body, but never the other way around. I could go on with many more achievements by Rudolf Clausius. By 1850, he was trying to connect a microscopic model of matter, today we would say atoms and molecules dashing about, with thermal phenomena. For instance, he correctly calculated the speed of oxygen molecules in air, almost 2,000 kilometers per hour, or the time it took them to hit the next oxygen molecule in the atmosphere. By 1850, he and a few others were convinced atomists already, without having any idea how atoms looked like or what they were. Rudolf Clausius was a child of his time, and he did not shy away from people. He was the privatissimi professor of the later Emperor Wilhelm II. He gave public talks on the new technology of refrigerators. He was elected rector of the University of Bonn in 1884 and 85. I find it personally outstanding and fascinating that Clausius gained his groundbreaking insights in an attempt to draw a consistent mathematical picture of the world, painting an image of the microscopic world, extending from the microscopic world, atoms and molecules, to macroscopic, to the macroscopic point of view. How do we transform heat energies? He is, if not in Germany, the father of theoretical, especially statistical physics. It is furthermore amazing that his physical understanding led him to draw and communicate far-reaching conclusions also for and to the society. Based on his findings, he could have shouted, "Do not produce that much entropy." Yeah? I see that you don't understand and that you wouldn't know what he is talking about. I think in his far-sighted speech from 1885, he therefore said, "The following centuries will have the task of introducing a wise economy in the use of what the sources of power in nature offer to us, and especially of not squandering wastefully what we find in the soil as a legacy of earlier times, and what cannot be replaced by anything." Undoubtedly, at least for myself, Rudolf Clausius was one of the greatest minds in the 19th century science, a generalist beyond disciplines and a far-sighted citizen. I wish everybody an enlightening evening commemorating Rudolf Clausius' 200th birthday. He deserves it. Thank you for your attention.
Dear Dieter Meschede, thank you very much for this very, very good and brief introduction to Clausius. It's now my great honor to introduce the first speaker, the first Nobel laureate speaker, and it was a great honor for Bonn that Peter Föhringer and Dieter Meschede, who organized this program, were able to attract two Nobel Prize laureates. And the first speaker is Professor Jean-Marie Len. Jean-Marie Len is the founder of a chemistry above chemistry. And this had far-reaching consequences. It touches and solves the problems we are dealing with today. I'm talking about supramolecular chemistry. This is the chemistry how molecules bind together by non-covalent interactions. You all know that molecules are atoms covalently bound, but there's more to chemistry, and we will hear about this. Just let me briefly mention that in Bonn, we have a strong tradition in supramolecular chemistry with Arne Lützen, Sigurd Höger, Professor Farmolok, to name but a few, but we should also mention Karl-Heinz Dötz and most of all Fritz Vögtle. Fritz Vögtle created one of these molecules that he called Bonan, after our city Bonn. It possesses a rotaxan-like structure, that is, we have a wheel, and that is located around an axle. The Bonan has two wheels. Now, the specialty of Professor Jean-Marie Len are cryptons. That is, molecules that completely surround the host, and they are governed by key lock principle, which in turn helps to understand biochemistry and medicinal science. What connects these molecules to Clausius is that there is organization, so a change in entropy. We are very happy now to hear Nobel laureate Professor Jean-Marie Len talk about steps towards complex matter, chemistry.
Good evening. It's nice to be back here in Bonn, especially on this this occasion, which is very unique. I wanted to start with partially the joke, which was already taken away from me. The fact that the first 100 years, you had one Nobel Prize winner, then for the second, you had two, and now, of course, you have to start to look for three, for 300 years. But I then looked at what could relate me to Clausius, and I found that I think there are three things. One, he was a member of the Académie des Sciences. Second, he got the decoration of the Légion d'honneur. And third, he is a member of the Ordre pour le Mérite. I have the same, and so thank you, Rudolf. So this being said, let's look at the title of my lecture. As it was said, Steps Towards Complex Matter, and I would like to show you that chemistry has something to do with it. Of course, physics too, you have heard about. But we have to start for that, for looking at the steps very, very, very early on. Then, 13.7 billion years ago, there was a fluctuation of the vacuum, as one nowadays says, which gave rise to our universe. At that time, there was no chemistry, there was physics. Universe was much too hot for any chemistry to exist, but it cooled down rather quickly. So beyond the age of physics, when it cooled down enough to form particles, which then built up into atoms, which then began to unite into larger structures, molecules, the age of chemistry started in our universe a little bit about 300,000 years after the Big Bang. That's the age of chemistry. Chemistry continued to become more and more complex by mechanisms we can imagine, but not necessarily that we know exactly how it happened. Molecules became bigger, they began to have interactions to form vesicles, like a soap bubble, for instance, which is, let's say, a model of a cell, if you want. And then something happened on our Earth. Thanks to the complexification of matter, a new property appeared, which is life, and that was about here. That's the age of biology. But it doesn't stop there. The most important property to come is, in fact, thought. That's why we are here. Without thinking, we would not be here. We would be maybe living, but not thinking. And I represent that by the famous statue here of Auguste Rodin, the thinker. This is a very famous one, and I think it sort of represents really hard thinking, like we all try to do. What I want to point out also, first of all, is that these are steps towards more and more complex forms of matter, but also that the end of the screen doesn't mean that it's the end of the evolution of the universe. We are just sitting on a piece of dust in an enormous universe, and it will continue to evolve, and nobody will be able to stop it, and we better have to live with it. And those in certain domains in our society who would like to stop it, they have no chance. It will continue, but as we said at the end, it's now our task to see how it will continue. So, this has a little bit to do with two famous people of this city. In science, the one we celebrate today, Clausius, and in music, Ludwig. Tomorrow I see for at least the fifth or sixth or seventh time his birthplace. I cannot come to Bonn without going to that place. So, this evolution towards more and more complex form of matter are based on thermodynamics, which has something to do, as you have heard, with Rudolf Clausius. Now, this looks like an empty slide. No, that's a representation of our universe. Our universe is 68% dark energy, 27% dark matter, 95% darkness. Not too good. We're waiting for the physicists to tell us a bit more about it. But there's 5% visible matter. That's the matter that matters. We are part of it. That is why we're here. Forget about the 95%. We are part of the 5%. So, what is then the big question we have to ask? I think the biggest question for science: how does matter become complex? How can it go from particles to thinking organisms? And maybe there are even higher forms of complexity in the future of the evolution of our universe. We don't know. To give an answer to that question, mankind has invented what brings us here: science. And if you look at three domains of science, physics deals with the basic laws of the universe, the laws on which everything else depends. Biology studies the rules of life. They are not laws, they are rules. That's the way it functions. The laws are given by the way the physical laws. What is chemistry doing? Chemistry is trying to build the bridge. That is why I think chemistry has a very important mission. How can you go from general laws to these people sitting in the audience? Clausius, thermodynamics would not exist without a person who proposed it. There would not be general relativity without Albert Einstein. There would be no quantum theory without Max Planck. So probably, I wouldn't say the most important in general, but the one which concerns us most is how could that organism appear on a small piece of dust in an enormous universe, trying to understand the universe out of which it is born? That's, for me, the big question. So my answer to the question is by self-organization. That means nothing and everything. We understand what it means. It happened by itself on the basis of the structure of the laws of our universe. Now, thermodynamics are one of these laws driving our universe. One can consider that it is a cosmic imperative, that it is not an accident that life exists, that it is a product of the structure of our universe. This can be discussed. It's metaphysical, it's philosophical, but I'm personally convinced that it is a product of our universe. It is not an accident. It is unavoidable. Now, the chemical evolution of matter, in fact, preceded any biological evolution. The chemical evolution resulted from the action of electromagnetic forces on the bricks which constitute visible matter in our universe by random combinations, which then were, some were better than others. Better, Clausius, thermodynamically having an advantage. And so one can say that chemical evolution preceded biological evolution, which itself, in fact, is a chemical evolution because it rests on changes of rather simple groups, which we'll see in a moment, in a large molecule. So Darwinian evolution is a chemical evolution, and in fact, chemical evolution is a generalization of Darwinian evolution. One could even say there's a post-Darwinian way in which we will have to enter and to drive the evolution. Now, if you go back, just a little bit of history, because history of science, of course, you can spend years, and many people, many years. But 2,500 years ago, there were others, for sure. There were people in a small country called Greece who sort of thought about what matter could be, what the universe was constituted of. One of them, Empedocles, said that there were four elements. Aristotle was another one: fire, air, water, earth, and the combinations gave properties. It was a bit primitive, but it was an attempt. It was a first attempt. But at the same time, 2,500 years ago, there was somebody else had a much better view already: Democritus and Leucippus, but that doesn't have any writings of these people. Democritus said that universe is made matter. Sorry, matter is particulate. It's made of particles, which cannot be made smaller. In Greek, atomos is you cannot cut it into more pieces, atoms. So Democritus already understood that matter was particulate. Even it is said that, this is the interesting thing, that he may have based this opinion on an observation. And it is said that he put a layer of alcohol on the top of a layer of water, and in the morning, it was only one face. How do you want to mix things together if they are continuous? There must be particles. That is why when I give a general public lecture, I say you can go around the street of Bonn and convince everybody that matter is particulate. You take a piece of sugar, you take a glass of water, you put it in, and it dissolves. How can it dissolve if it's not particles? So it's a very simple, and if he really did that, I think he did an experiment showing that his idea was correct. That is not just a philosophical idea, it's a proof, scientific experimental proof. Now, many years later, of course, then scientists, researchers have tried to find out what is this sort of matter made of. They found that it was made of elements which could be put in a sort of a collection, but the collection had no order. It was sort of chaotic, like a zoo, with a label, but you don't know how to classify things. Until the middle of the 19th century, where a number of people proposed a classification. The most famous and the most successful one was proposed by Dmitri Mendeleev, who in 1869 published the following paper. You will see the original. That's the original paper, the page. I consider that as one of the most important papers in science ever, because he tries to put in this paper ordering here the elements known at that time. And for instance, now they are columns and not lines, but it has, you have here a boron, carbon, nitrogen, oxygen, fluorine, and so on and so on. So in addition, he found that things were lacking. He put a question mark, and he was convinced it would be found. And of course, they were found. So this is now known as the periodic table of elements, which relates the properties of the elements to their atomic weight. That's a way to classify them, giving that order. And it's now called the periodic table of elements. What I'm telling you, all of you know, but I want to insist on characteristics. The fact that this paper is such an important paper. And now, how does it look? Oh, yeah, sorry, I forgot one thing. I have a question for you. Wer sie nicht kennte die Elemente, ihre Kraft und Eigenschaft, wäre kein Meister über die Geister. Who said that? Okay? No answer? Ah, come on. Ja, Goethe. Faust. Faust is also science, you must say. Huh? We are all sort of Faust in spirit. That's the erste Teil. Yes. Im Studierzimmer. Interesting. It's a fantastic piece, that Faust. But okay, we can talk that at dinner this evening or something. So, this is now the table as it is. The periodic table of the elements. Now, you know it, but did you think deeply about the fact that you have in front of your eyes the only bricks and all of the bricks visible matter is made of? Realize what that means. Anywhere in our universe, the elements will be the same. Anywhere in our universe, combinations of these elements will be the same. We'll have the same properties. It looks very dogmatic. It bothers me. Science has not have nothing to do with dogma. We have to think. But between 1 and 2 and 3 and 4 and 5, these are entire numbers. There's nothing. So one proton, one electron, two protons, two electrons, three protons, three electrons, nothing between. So this table is complete. Of course, you could make it bigger by the end. This is what physicists do in accelerators and so on. But the ones which are really present in living matter, they are there. And anywhere a carbon-carbon bond is a carbon-carbon bond. I find that incredible. You know, baffling. You imagine we're sitting on this piece of dust and we know that the map, what our universe, the visible matter, is made of. When an experiment doesn't work, you can look at the table and say, anyway, science has done something, even if my experiment hasn't worked today. So this is the playground of chemistry. Chemists are like children, like Lego. This is the Lego set of chemistry. So using that, you can then build lots of things, infinity number of things. And this is, I think, this what attracted me to chemistry, this possibility of building up. At that time, it didn't think so deeply, but new expressions of matter. And that is what chemists can do. Now, from the atom to the molecule, you take elements, you link them by strong bonds, and you build up molecular chemistry. Two examples to sort of give milestones. One of them is, you could maybe choose another one, but people sort of agree that the making in the laboratory of urea from ammonium cyanate by Friedrich Wöhler in 1828 was a milestone in the art and science of making new forms of matter and transforming matter. Furthermore, it's also an interesting example of how a very, now this is a small thing, in terms of in the times of Wöhler, of course, was very important, but he was very conscious that it had another consequence, let's say a metaphysical one. At that time, one was convinced that you could not produce in a laboratory any molecule contained in a living organism without the help of the vital force, sort of magic force you have to apply to make something which is contained in a living organism. And Wöhler was very conscious that by doing this transformation, he had killed that idea of vital force, and he wrote to Berzelius about that and said, I have been able to make urea from ammonium cyanate without the help of any organism, being man or dog. This is a famous letter of Wöhler to Berzelius. Now, 150 years later, molecular chemistry succeeded in the total synthesis, that means the building up element by element of a very complex molecule, vitamin B12. That was at that time, in the 70s of last century, this was at that time the Everest of molecular chemistry. But this was not done alone. There were two groups collaborating, one of Robert Burns Woodward at Harvard, the other one of Albert Eschenmoser at the ETH in Zurich, helped by, of course, two laboratories of many people for 10 years or so. I was one of them. That is, wait a minute. This is my piece here. No, I show that not because it's my piece, but to say that we are all scientists. We bring to science a small stone or a big stone, but it's our stone, it's our contribution. Here, I was one among 120 or something like that, men and women years, and I think it's just that you, it's like an artist, and you make your contribution to an enormous architecture, and it's your contribution. Nobody can take it away from you. Now, of course, in the last 50 years, since vitamin B12 was made, molecular chemistry has developed much, much more new reactions, new products, new drugs, new materials, and it will, I wouldn't do the synthesis the same way anymore, very probably, would be more efficient and all that. So it has developed and it will continue, and molecular chemistry has existed, has still exists, and will exist in the future, because there are still many, many new molecules and properties to develop, to discover. But then we have to ask a question. What beyond the molecule? To introduce that, let me give you some biology. The blue sphere is a cancer cell. The other bodies are killer cells. Briefly said, the killer cells have to find out which cells have become cancerous and to destroy them. If they make a mistake, you have a big problem. Either they destroy a healthy cell or they do not destroy a cancer cell. How do they know? These are a bunch of molecules defined by membranes. What's going on? That's a white blood cell, colored in rose for the picture. And the blue dots is the HIV virus. And we have a famous virus going around this room, maybe not too many of them, I hope. And the virus is something which, when it finds the right port of entry, will infect a cell. How does a virus know? The virus doesn't think. It is purely thermodynamics, if I may say. So there must be something which tells one body what the other one is. And they are, of course, you know that, they are defined by a membrane. The membrane has molecules, and in this membrane, some molecules define the identity of the other guy. And so when they get together, they sort of feel out what happens and what the other one is, if it's the right partner or not. And this then led to the fact that molecular chemistry then developed into what one can call supramolecular chemistry. It's just a way to say that it lies beyond molecular chemistry. And then this then was studied for many years in many laboratories, of course in Bonn, there were, Fritz Voigtler was already mentioned, there were many others, and it's studied mostly molecular recognition processes, I come back to that, reactivity between molecular entities, and transport processes. That was something which at that time was not very much done in organic chemistry. Physicists, and especially physical chemists, they knew about transport, and also the biologist, what goes through membranes. But in organic chemistry, there was the work of membrane transport did not exist. So, but it was, one can make major illustrations and contribution to that concept by this. So, molecular recognition is the first property of interest and of importance. And in order to simplify things, to have a small but a very, very, very strong picture, let's see what one can say. Of course, molecular recognition first needs interactions for binding. If there is no binding, there's no interaction, so they don't know. Their bodies don't interact. They ignore each other. But you need, in addition, information. So this means that what happens between molecules is based on molecular information. It has to do with the behavior of molecular societies, the way molecules talk to each other, if I may say. Sometimes I like to call it a sort of a molecular sociology. What are the molecules doing when they see they like each other, they repel each other, they do some things together. So you can see there's a double complementarity in geometry and in interactions, and there was already a very strong picture given by Emil Fischer when he published another very famous paper in 1894 that an enzyme can act on its substrate if it fits together like Schloss und Schlüssel, like a lock and a key. Of course, we know that things are a bit soft, they can accommodate and so on, but basically it was a very strong picture. And this lecture is a sort of the general public lecture. I think if people understand that what happens in their body has to do with locks and keys, with the way in which the molecules in the body recognize each other, that is enough for the evening. Because we are here because of that. If our molecules could not recognize one another, do the right thing in the right place, we wouldn't exist. So molecular recognition is, I would say, the basis of life. Look that since we are in the general public here, Emil Fischer got his doctorate in Strasbourg in 1874. At that time, the French had lost the Franco-Prussian War. So Alsace had become part of the empire on the other side of the Rhine. And in order to convince Alsatians to remain Germans, university was created, which was the only imperial university, with the one in Berlin at that time. And a lot of very famous people were sent to our university, one of them being Adolf von Bayer, and one of his students was Emil Fischer. the second Nobel Prize winner in chemistry. The first one was Van't Hoff, and the second one was Emil Fischer. Now we are in Europe. These things are of the past. That is my European's stance. You may have noted I am a strongly convinced European, yeah? So, what is the most important information storage for us? It's, of course, you know, DNA. That what makes a human being different from a tomato or an elephant from a dog. And if you look at the chemistry of this thing, the storage of the genomic information in a just a string of rather trivial molecules, molecular structures, phosphate, a small sugar, another phosphate, and four groups which are sticking on this strand. These groups are much, much simpler than vitamin B12. This is some heterocyclic entity. And just four of them. So we depend on four letters in a given order. We come back to Y4. How can you read? This is storage of the information. How can you read it? You read it by the fact that they can pair up. They can pair up that 2 points of interaction or 3 points of interaction. That's a binary system. So life on our Earth is, and the development and the generation of given organisms depends on four letters, a sequence of four letters, and two ways of reading. Why four letters? Possibly because it was enough to do the system. Possibly in evolution, 5 or 6 or 7 letters have been tried, like, for instance, some people like Peter Schulz and others have tried to add letters to the genome. This is an interesting field of experimentation, but probably with more, it gets chaotic, and it wouldn't work. So it was sticking with four and two ways of reading. I think it's quite trivial, but it is rather powerful. Okay, it's not just that, because you need correcting systems, you need a lot of other things. Life is much more complicated, but the basis is really very simple. So chemistry is defined usually as the science of structure and transformation of non-living and living matter. But in addition, I claim, and I think you must agree, that it is also a science of informed matter. Information is stored in the molecule, in the way, in its shape, in its atoms, in the way they, just the structure of the molecule. And the reading, the processing is by contact. So the information storage is molecular, the information processing is supramolecular. Of course, then people have begin to play with locks and keys. Here, a la Emil Fischer, you see here, this is a lock here. There are three keys, and one of them fits. Obvious, but you can make it in many nice ways. You can have very simple ones, like the ones we started with, taking a sphere, like a sodium ion, or potassium ion, or a rubidium ion, and making cages for selecting one and the other. In fact, I was inspired I was interested in neurochemistry, the chemistry of the nervous system. And as a poor chemist, I was wondering, how can I address something like that? The simplest thing was that the action potential, the nerve impulse, is based on changes of sodium and potassium across a nerve membrane. But this is for chemists not too difficult, sodium and potassium, so you must try to recognize them, to be able to handle them, and so on. So a lot of things happened then, and many people studied these properties of molecular recognition over the years in many, many laboratories. Now, if we want to have a very quick look at some real applications in the field, and we'll only show some we have been working on, just results very quickly. The first is, of course, drug discovery. What is a drug? A la Emil Fischer, a drug is a molecular key for a biological lock. As simple as that. Of course, it's not very simple in practice, but that is the principle. You want to make a molecule which does a very specific thing as selectively as possible to a biological one, so as to modify it, amplify, or inhibit. Now, we have then also worked on these cages. We have made different types of cages, and this is one of them. where in the cage of a different structure than the original ones, you can introduce europium ions, then it becomes strongly luminescent, red luminescence, and this can then be used to label immunoproteins and to make machinery for an apparatus for medical diagnostics based on this label. And of course, the searching element was the immunoprotein. Then there is the question of transport. And we had studied quite a bit transport. I will not say anything about that. But one thing I want to mention is gene transfer. It's a transport process, and it's an artificial one. So here, second point I like to make, transporting a gene into a cell with the help of some kind of organic molecule. Some people use a virus. That's not something I want to talk about. But making sort of a coat of leap of greasy positive charges, if I may say. Greasy positive charges, positive because they won't have to bind to the gene, and greasy because they have to go through a membrane, otherwise it doesn't go through. And we know also now we have this type of procedure has benefited much from the work done on, in general terms, on deriving vectors for gene transfer. This has been very much used for, again, the virus, which we have all to battle with. It is also of importance for biotechnology and for much of the future of, I think, our societies and mankind. We need genetically modified organisms. Some people want to stop them. It will not be possible, at least I hope so, but I'm quite convinced it will not be possible. We have to be able to use our knowledge to modify organisms to our benefit. We can talk a bit later about whether we want to modify ourselves, but that's another point, it comes later. Then also materials of supramolecular nature. And here I give you just one example. In 1990, we had been working on deriving supramolecular polymers where the monomers are hooked together by non-covalent interactions rather than by covalent ones. And it happens that after this, many people began to work about it, on it, but also a small, at that time, startup company, Xeltis, in the Netherlands, had developed, thanks to the help of many polymer chemists, for instance, Bert Meyer in Eindhoven, on developing biomaterials out of these supramolecular polymers, making them biocompatible. And in 2013, I got a message from this company, Xeltis, where they said, we have used these biomaterials to make a material which can be used for the reconstruction of the heart of children who had a very severe cardiac malformation. And here is the first little girl, Dominica, in 2013, who was operated by Leo Bucheria in Moscow. Don't forget, Russia is a big country. We have problems with it a lot, but science has no borders. So, this was in 2013, anyway. So, they were both very happy. I think I like especially also the expression of the surgeon. He looks like a real surgeon, huh? Doesn't he? And quite happy. And then, of course, many children were operated, and the same company developed also heart valves and so on, okay, which have been implanted in different regions and so on. I want just to show you, also to make you aware of the fact that if you want to introduce something in a human body, it may take very, very long. And if you knew at the beginning how long it would take, you probably would not start it. And it requires a lot of things, huh? Not just your work at the beginning, but you have to have some people have to see there is a future there for doing something else. You make a new material, you have to get the finances for it, and so on and so on. You regulate regulatory bodies and all that. So one has to do it, but one should not think at how long it would take, because as I said, you wouldn't start it. Another property of supramolecular polymers is that they are self-healing. Here you see a very nice transparent film, which is cleaved in two. These are the fingers of my Indian postdoc who made the compound. Somebody cuts it in two. You superimpose the two parts and you press with your finger. And after a minute or two, you can stretch and it sticks. So self-healing materials is also one of the possible applications of supramolecular interactions. Now, let's go back to this, the driving force, which I mentioned at the beginning, the fact that matter can self-organize. And if we know more about how recognition occurs, how we can construct entities which will be recognizing themselves, then we can try to build up systems which will undergo self-organization, which means the generating of complex organized structures on the basis of the information which is there, and of course the interactions between the pieces, which then leads to the final object. The best way, I will not talk about passive or active self-organization, this would be much too long, but it's a sort of a program which is running, which generates an output, and the best way to illustrate it is a biological example, is just the virus. The self-organization of the tobacco mosaic virus, which was the first one to be understood, is a very simple case, which looks like magic, but it is absolutely not magic. We understand everything that happens there. It's a building, if I may say, architecture, built from 2,130 BRICS, protein subunits. They have a shape and interaction such that they can recognize one side recognizes the other one. And if you have a shape like a piece of pie, like shown here, a piece of pie, then they can get together, they go around the circle, and they assemble. And that is spontaneous, controlled by the way in which the bricks are built and by which they interact with their RNA, because the RNA forms the vernier, the thing that gives you the lens of the tower. And so this is an example of how molecular matter can organize by itself. Okay, I have a story, but I think if I continue with the story, it will be much too long. So maybe later on. So then in the laboratory, chemists have tried to see if one can do things like that, if it's possible to make systems which will generate rather complicated architectures on the basis of the elements and how you build them. So the components could be organic molecules, the bricks, and the cementing units could be metal ions which bind together, and then you can generate a variety of architectures. We made a double helix, a triple helix, helicates. Here you see the metal, you don't see them here, they're hidden, but here there are three metal ions, in this case it's three nickel. You can make grids where metal ions bind at the intersection of organic molecules, are held together in this way. You can make circular molecules, certain helical molecules. You can make nanocylinders where you have linear molecules in red, flat molecules in blue, 12 cations. You mix the thing together and you get that stuff. It looks, when you see it, it looks like magic. And I have seen very nice examples in my discussions here just a moment ago here in the chemistry department. So there's another point to that, is that this kind of trying to and succeeding in organizing in very complex architectures, complicated structures, can also be of great interest for nanoscience and nanotechnology. Because if you are able to make building blocks which have the information such that it will lead to an output, which is maybe a device like these computers, of course can dream, they may not necessarily be a computer, but you may come to what you may call the ultimate fabrication to let the pieces make itself. If you have the right building blocks, a virus does that, huh? The right building blocks lead to the output, the structure you want to make. And this could well be also a possibility in the future. You know, to convince you that it should work for computers, most powerful computer for the moment, right now, is the one up between our two ears. You don't make it, it makes itself. Of course, it's a very, very complicated process, but it's made by itself. So, the problem is to know how, but not the fact that it will work. It will work. Now, this self-organization I just mentioned very briefly is by design. You design your building blocks and you let it run, a sort of a program, and it has an output, which is a sort of a structure which has given functions. But then the step beyond this is to try to make systems which are able to choose what they need to beat themselves up. That means beyond this is having systems which work by selection. For this, you need diversity in building blocks, because you can only choose if you have many different things. And again, in the department here, they have there's very nice chemistry going on in that respect. But you need also dynamics. You don't want the first collision to give something which is too strong, because you have not been able to explore the hypersurface of energy and structure. So it has to be able to explore, to detach, to look, and to look for something, and to find the deepest hole in the surface. And this then leads to what I like to call by a little bit complicated name, but a constitutional dynamic chemistry. That means a chemistry which is dynamic not by the motion, not by the reaction, but the fact that the constitutional object itself can fall to pieces, reassociate, redissociate, reassociate, and if there is a change in the environment, it may be different. In other words, it can then adapt to changes, and then this is what we now mostly work on, adaptive chemistry. Now, this is a little bit more for chemists here, because I thought, I said that last section is very general again, but I thought I should give a little bit on chemistry. So, this constitutional dynamic chemistry, which leads to the variations in constitution by exchanging pieces, then allows for adaptation, and it can be used as methods for searching for biologically active molecules I show you it on a slide, in fact. Dynamic nanostructures, no time to talk about. Dynamic materials, I have an example also. So let's first look at what is the process by which you could use this type of unstable molecules. You know, this is something horrendous. When you have a graduate student coming wanting to make a PhD, you tell him or her that they should work on unstable molecules. They look at you with big eyes and say, what is this guy telling us? We learn all the time that we want to make molecules which are stable, which don't fall apart. And now he tells us, well, we want the molecules which fall apart. So you have some time, you need some time to convince that it is worth doing. Now, let me show you how, again, thermodynamics comes into play. The search for biologically adaptive substances can be thermodynamically driven. If you have a bunch of components of different types of different structures, like shown here, and they can then generate the whole space of all possible combinations, be they there or not yet, but all the space of all possible combinations is open. So what can you do with this? This is a terrible mixture. You use a very simple law of thermodynamics. Unfortunately, it is not close use. It's Le Chatelier, the principle of Le Chatelier. If you add a receptor to that, the receptor will bind best the one which fits best. So the lock will assemble its own key, because that's the best bound. And so it uses the combination which is the best and amplifies it. This has been applied in a number of cases, like for drug discovery, like making enzyme inhibitors or substrates for biological or synthetic receptors. Just the principle. I would have to talk about a number of things, concentrations, how much is enough to have a result, and so on. But the principle is simply an application of thermodynamics. And it's, you may call it also, an adaptation of the system of equilibrium entities to the addition of something new. The new thing modifies the system and makes the system, all these things talk to one another. If you add something new, this will change the distributions, and all the people in the population around, we know that something has happened. Now, about materials, let me illustrate that in the following way. Please hang on, because I will be a bit quick and without too much detail. If you take two polymeric films, made one by combining A with B, and another one by combining A prime with B prime, if the connections between AB and A prime B prime is dynamic, they can dissociate and reassociate. So in addition to AB and A prime B prime, the two other combinations, A, B prime, and A prime, B, are in potentially available. if you put them on top of one another. So if you put them on top of one another, at this position here, you may create the other ones, the recombination. And then maybe color appears, maybe fluorescence appears. And that is optical, so like you see it, and that is quite convincing. So my Japanese co-workers, I was working at that time, sort of collaborating with Mitsui Chemicals in Japan, so they were sending us, sending to my group co-workers. They were doing the basic work, and then they wanted to develop it in their research center in Chiba. So this is typically a Japanese piece, you know, very nice origami type, you know, where you have a cat where the head and the ear is AB, the mustache, the eyes, and the inside of the ears is A prime, pre prime. They're superimposed. You heat, and you get color and fluorescence where it's superimposed. That means at these positions, the rearrangements occur. Of course, we knew that one of them would be colored and fluorescent. Otherwise, you don't do the experiment if you don't know what is coming out. So there's only there that it happens. So this can be, it was not exploited, but for instance, if you have nice films, you can write at the interface with a laser, and you can write in three dimensions if you want. Well, maybe there's some interesting applications there too. Now comes the a little bit more difficult part, but I wanted to show it to you because that's what is very tempting for me. That's what motivates me right now. And you know, I'm not at the beginning of my career, so I need some motivation. So what about these mixtures? These are complex systems, these are mixtures. And as I said, if you do anything to one entity in this thing, the other ones will very probably know about. So how can we look at this? We can say that the four components, AA prime, BB prime, which can combine into AB, A prime, B, AB prime, and A prime, B prime, they form a population of interchanging entities, which can undergo reversible combinations. So what is the smallest network? I chose four because that you can represent. It's a square, very simply. It's just a square. Now you position these things at the corners of the square. And then you analyze what happens. If you look at the edges of the square, the constituents share a component. AB shares A with AB prime, and B with A prime B. So if now a little Maxwell daemon comes and amplifies AB, how can it do it? In a closed system, it can only do it at the expense of AB prime and A prime B. Okay? But in doing so, it liberates A prime and B prime, which can make A prime, B prime. So on the edges, you have antagonists. If something changes of the ones, one of these constituents, the ones which are linked by the edges, they go the opposite way. If AB increases, the ones which are linked to it go down. But the ones on the diagonal, they go up. They go the same way. And that is something so trivial in some way, but you have to realize that it means that in a complex mixture, the relationships between the objects which interchange pieces can go the same way and not the opposite way. And this means that if you apply physical stimuli or chemical effectors, you have what I like to call agonist amplification. That means the fittest for doing a given thing amplifies also the unfittest of doing that thing. But maybe this unfittest does something else of interest, like having a color or fluorescence. But I think also maybe in developmental biology, it may have some interest. The fact that the fittest for a given environment, a given action, a given agent, it also amplifies the unfittest. I'm not sure developmental biologists have thought in things in that way, but maybe it would be something to explore. So let me just show the last slide, which is scientific and then is a bit more general. That's the following. We have now developed three systems where the fact that the system gets more organized favors the generation of that piece entity which makes the organization. So that means the following. Suppose you have a solution with four constituents. There can be the AB, AB prime, which I just mentioned, and so on. Solution is not organized, it is organized. Now it happens that one of these pieces is able to form a more organized state of matter, like a gel, then you will amplify the one which forms the gel. And if you heat, if it's a gel, of course, cooling is a way to make a gel. A gel has a melting point. Then you heat again, and you go back to the more or less stochastic distribution, which means that you can create a self-amplification organization. It means that in a system where you exchange entities, if one of them knows that at the end of the line it will lead to a gel, it will do it. It will be amplified by the formation of the gel. So it is a self-catalysis of organization. I think personally that that is one of the driving forces of our universe. And we are here because matter knows that it wants to get organized and generates the entity which will lead to better organization. Now, that is a very big statement, so to say, but in simple cases, you can demonstrate it, and you can demonstrate in different ways in which what is order and so on. For instance, by local, just for the chemist, looking at NMR line widths, broad lines means less motion, sharp lines means more motion, and so you have a way to a scale for looking at organization, and you can then see that there is more selection when there are broader NMR lines, which are more organization. Sorry, that's a bit going a bit too far. I come back once to Bonn and we talk about these things. So chemistry is molecular. We have to how to make molecules. That's our trade. Supramolecular, to control how molecules behave, populations of molecules. Then organization occurs. These things organize. And on the basis of thermodynamics, huh? Good old Rudolf. And dynamic, yes, has to be dynamic to be able to search. Then it can become adaptive. Of course, evolutive, you would say, is the next step. Evolutive is a step where you adapt, but if you take away the one which has led to adaptation, of course, it goes back to average. But if you do this, we have done sort of studied. You add the first lock, the first lock. Then you get the key for the lock, and then you can do a chemical reaction to fix that, and then you can go another step. That would be a little bit like an evolution, keeping the characters which have been acquired to go a step further. And that is going towards complex matter. Now, let's be a bit more general again. First of all, thermodynamics drives self-organization. And self-organization drives the emergence of complex matter. And I'm convinced that the fact that a system can get organized in presence of the possibility to reconstitute, to reassemble pieces, will lead to the generation of the piece which leads to the self-organization, sort of an autocatalysis of self-organization. So, for chemistry, let's celebrate chemistry a bit. Huh? Chemistry, and that is Ike's why I'm a chemist, can really create, we'll come back to that word in a moment, noble expressions of complex matter. The book of chemistry is not just a book of nature. Of course, you have to read that. You have to read it, you have to understand what has already been produced on our planet by natural evolution. But the book has also to be written. You can make many, many objects which are not yet there and things which very probably exist nowhere in the universe at a big statement. So you never know, the universe is very big, so we don't know whether it happens or not. But we can discuss about one molecule, which is one of my favorite, which I think there's little chance that any natural process will lead to it. Let me just get the name. Bulvaline, the molecule where carbon-carbon bonds are never the same, that has been made by Gerhard Schröder in Karlsruhe. We can talk a bit more about that. It's a very exciting molecule. Very simple thing, but good idea. So the score of chemistry has to be composed, not just to be played. So chemistry has a really creative power. and chemistry can be considered as the art of matter. Now, this sounds very new, but there was already somebody who was not a minor person in mankind, Leonardo da Vinci. He wrote a sentence which, for somebody who was a scientist, an engineer, and an artist, a very strong one. Let's read it slowly. Where nature finishes to produce its own species, we are part of that. We are part of what nature produced, evolution. Man begins, scientists, with help of science, of course, using natural things. That's the periodic table of elements. These are the bricks we have at our disposal, in harmony with this very nature. Rudolf, thermodynamics, laws of physics. We can only use these laws. We have to follow them, otherwise nothing works. And then comes the end, which for an artist of his caliber is, of course, an extremely strong statement. To create an infinity of species. To create an infinity of species. So that's for us to do that. So not just natural, man-made. I go back to Greek mythology. This is Prometheus. He has stolen the fire from the gods, and he runs away to give it to mankind. So he looks over his shoulder because the other guys are running after him, trying to catch him. And he wants to escape. He gives it to mankind, he succeeds, and he shows the fire of knowledge and of science. But we cannot give it back. What we know, we know. You cannot erase knowledge. We have to live with it. Either you can stop everything. I don't think we will do it. But once we have the knowledge, we have to live with it. It is not different from what nature did. Nature gave us hands. With hands, I can caress or strangle. It's our choice. So we have the knowledge. The use of the knowledge is then what we have to learn. So one can say that our path leads us from the quest for more and more knowledge to the control of our own destiny. I have once written a very general paper, because this is a bit shocking for many people, but man modifying man is contained in man. Because we are a natural product, and what we do is necessarily a consequence of what a natural product can do. We can discuss that too. So I have not said much about mathematics. Let me conclude with mathematics. David Hilbert, a very famous mathematician, he wrote this. He gave two sentences in one of his talks. First of all, one is the drive. Wir müssen wissen. We must know. Although you understand, wir müssen wissen very well. I don't need to translate it. The second sentence is even stronger. It's a vote of confidence. Wir werden wissen. For a mathematician, that is interesting, huh? But it applies to all sciences. So science shows us the way. We will know. Science will shape our future. We have to participate. That is the other hero of Bonn, Ludwig van Beethoven, who gave to the world the most beautiful hymn of joy and peace. And it allows me also to make a comparison with physics, for instance, to say the following. Chemistry is to physics what music is to the laws of acoustics. Now, the thing is, you know, laws of acoustics are fundamental. You cannot go, if you want to make music, there are laws of acoustics. But the laws of acoustics don't tell you the final hymn of the Ninth Symphony. That's an expression, somebody has to put it together, a creation with it. But the general laws are there. You cannot get a queen statue. So I like to say that chemistry is to physics what music is to the laws of acoustics. Finally, there's a last feature of science which has really to be spread. I think most of you, all of you, are probably convinced. But science has this property which no other human endeavor has: no borders. Science is the same for everybody. No politics, no flags, no language, no separations, no borders. And the spirit of science is more than we don't want to be everybody to be chemists. We don't want to be everybody to be thermodynamicists. We need pianists, we need violinists, we need bakers, we need all these people who make up a society, artists. But science has this feature that it unites necessarily by its very essence, mankind. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Lin, for this beautiful talk about chemistry, showing us the evolution of chemistry and showing us what is really important in science: no borders. Thank you very much. Let's thank him again. We come now to the next point of this evening, and it's a piece of music. So I'm happy to welcome our musicians now. Niels Wandelt and Christian Klein, who are performing two pieces of Rachmaninoff. Thank you. Thank you, Niels Wandel and Christian Klein. We will have now a break for 15 minutes, so please be back 10 to 8. And I want to announce that there are refreshments, so please feel free to get some water outside, but please come back. Thank you all for coming back. We will now turn to the second part of the Clausius celebration, and I'm very happy to announce our second guest of honor, Nobel laureate Professor Stephen Chu, who works at Stanford University. Also here, I would like to avoid repeating all the biographical data, what you can find in the internet anyway. Only one impressive fact I would like to mention. You were appointed Secretary of Energy under the Obama legislation, and you held that position for 4 years. So you left science for 4 years, which was probably not an easy thing to do, but you did it. And I want to briefly mention, going back to the science, that Stephen Chu inseminates both theoretical and experimental physicists and chemists, which is visible in his work. He's an expert in trapping molecules. So he does this by using optics and lasers. For example, he created an atomic fountain interferometer. So he is an artist as well. Also, his research reaches further than simply being physics. He touches chemistry, biochemistry, mathematics, and he makes important and far-reaching contributions to environmental science. And he likes cheese, what he told us this morning. He's talking today about non-equilibrium statistical physics and the thermodynamics of molecular motors. And from this title, you hear already how many different fields Stephen Chu is touching and working on. And this connects also nicely to the talk of Jean-Marie Len and leads us to Rudolf Clausius. We welcome again Professor Stephen Chu, and we are happy to hear you talk.
So, thank you very much for the kind introduction. I'm delighted to be here to celebrate Clausius's 100th anniversary. I want to begin by telling you things I'm sure you already know. First, remind you of the laws of thermodynamics appropriately carved in marble, that energy is conserved, that heat never passes from cold to hot, but only from hot to cold bodies, and that the entropy of the system when it approaches the constant value when you go to zero temperature. Clausius, in part, was responsible for all of these laws. But before I briefly go into that, I just want to remind you why this is held in such high esteem, or that it is held in such high esteem. Classical thermodynamics is the only physical theory of universal content that will be never overthrown, said Albert Einstein. Sir Arthur Stanley Eddington said, "The law to entropy always increases. The second law of thermodynamics holds, I think, the supreme position among the laws of nature. If your pet theory of the universe is against the second law of thermodynamics, there's nothing for it but to collapse in deepest humiliation." And finally, London said, "For the second law, I will burn it to stake." So there's real devotion here. I'm going to briefly mention the pioneering work of Sadi Carnot and then go to Rudolf Clausius. Now, in this development of Clausius from about 1850 to 1880, he was going back and forth between William Thomson and Lord Kelvin. But when the dust has settled, as Gibbs noted, it was Clausius who was really seen as the father of thermodynamics. So let me start with Carnot. He was an engineer working in the army, and he wanted to think about this steam engine, which had been developed, invented by Newcomb, improved greatly by James Watt. But what was the real limit of this so-called steam engine? And so he did something extraordinary. But to tell you what he did, he first let me imagine you're a hiker, you can go up and down mountains, but you can do it in a frictionless sort of way. So you expend no extra energy going up and down mountains. So if you start from the start and go to the finish, I hope you can see this tiny little pointer in the start and finish. If there is no friction, the energy expended from start to finish is the same. Another way of putting it is you can go from the start along one path, you get to the top, you go back down the other path, and the time integral of the work done is zero. And so what Carnot thought of is, suppose you have heat. We know the steam engine used heat. So he idealized the steam engine. It's not condensing into water and going back into vapor, but he just said, suppose you let the piston on contact with heat go very, very slowly. So all the molecules, now you might say, was there molecules? Well, inadvertently, yes, there had to have been molecules. Subconsciously, Cazes definitely knew there were molecules. As pointed out in one of the introductions, he was partly responsible for this, but you'll see in more detail. If you let this piston expand very slowly, all those molecules are climbing very fast, and because the collision is very rapid, you can actually transfer the heat energy from a hot temperature T1 into the gas. And so this is the closest thing to a frictionless engine as possible, and it's this closest thing to frictionless that said must be the ideal engine. And what he concluded was the motive power of heat is independent of agents employed to realize it. Its quantity is fixed solely by the temperatures of the bodies between which it is effective. Finally, the transfer of caloric. I'll redefine this, or Clausius actually redefined what those words meant. But the fundamental idea is the best engine you could ever have is a frictionless engine. If you get a frictionless engine, there's nothing going to be better. And that was Sadi Carnot. So Clausius, in 1850, his first landmark paper, actually combines Boyle's law and, it's not Boyle's law, it's Dalton's law, into PV equals some constant times an offset times a temperature. He used the Celsius temperature scale. And in 1854, he goes on further to figure out what this mysterious thing that Carnot was talking about, that is doing the work. And he established that this parameter, 1 over T, which is related to this T, which it has this funny little offset, says that the heat input is related to this change in energy, but with this other factor of 1 over T. And he found that Carnot's condition of the pistons was Q1 over T1 equals Q2 over T2 equals zero. So in the circular thing, going up the hill and coming back down, it's equal to zero. And he said that this circular thing, he didn't call it entropy at the time, had to be equal to zero. So this is Clausius' formal mathematics in 1854. 1865, he identifies this as entropy. And so what Clausius did between 1850 and 1865 is he said the motive power of heat turned out to be the efficiency of the reversible engine, the frictionless engine, and the transfer of caloric turned out to be the reversible transfer of entropy with this T factor, 1 over T being this mysterious thing. Now, if you were confused with this, you're not alone. I was confused with it for decades when I learned about entropy, and there is a lot of confusion, but what's made it even worse is that there was no meter that measures entropy. There's no entropy meter, and it's not like these other external variables like the volume of the system or the particle number. There's no entropy meter. And as pointed out in a textbook by Cattell and Cromer, the utility of the conception of entropy is limited by the fact that it does not correspond directly to any measurable physical property, but is merely a mathematical function of the definition of absolute temperature. Clausius was the one who realized that using an ideal gas law, taking it to its limit, that was the way you measure temperature. So again, he was really partially responsible for the third law. Okay, so it turns out that may not be true, what Cattell and Romer said. You can maybe measure entropy. Now, how do we know this? Well, it goes, I'm going to jump forward several centuries, a century and a half. And there is a physicist, a mathematical physicist named Landauer working at IBM, York Kent Heights. And he started to wonder, what is the minimum amount of energy you need to read one bit of memory and then reset it? One bit, either zero or one. Okay, but if you think about resetting one bit, zero, one, and you think about what we know of entropy today is, namely, it's the number of accessible states. It's not this caloric thing that Carnot was talking about. He found that if you have something, it could be either zero or one, two possibilities, two accessible states. You read it out, it's either zero or one. That's something irreversible. So therefore, you must do something to that to reset it. And he said, because of that, he gets that this minimum energy you need is defined by entropy, which is KT log 2, if the machine is working at temperature T. All right? This is a remarkable result, that reading out a single bit of memory and resetting it at some equilibrium surrounding temperature has to be KT log 2. Okay, very recently, very sensitive single bit readout has occurred, and they're within KT log 2. This is a, it's actually done by a friend of mine who, when I was at Bell Labs and I was a department head, he was one of the people in my department. That didn't mean he worked for me, I worked for him, but just like, you know, department chairs work for their faculty. Rectors work for their faculty. Anyway, so Jeff Boker showed that this black line is the Landauer limit as you go to higher and higher temperature, and the red line is the fitted data of his one-bit readout. So in a certain sense, you're beginning to actually get to the quantum level of entropy, one bit. Okay? So it's more real than you think. But let me continue the saga of entropy. And this is Ludwig Boltzmann, and his tomb is that entropy is equal to Boltzmann's constant times the log W of the number of accessible states. And again, this one bit, either 0 or 1 means log 2. All right. Now, it's more complicated because in addition to entropy, you also have normal energy, enthalpic energy, and in 1872, Gibbs showed that the available energy in a thermodynamic system is equal to the free energy, which is the normal enthalpic energy, minus T times the change in entropy. Now, I'm going to show you a movie of a piece of DNA. It's a piece of DNA being held by an optical tweezer. And in the surrounding blackness are other pieces of DNA. So it's actually a solution, a polymer solution of DNA. And although this experiment was done to show a theory called reptation that was suggested by Degenne, and when Degenne got his Nobel Prize in 1991 or two, he's smiling in College of France and pointing to the word reptation on the blackboard. I didn't know what reptation was, so I said, well, what is that? And so I did this experiment to show it's true. But you see that polymer, it's relaxing in this tube of other polymers as a rubber band. So here's my question. If you take states of a polymer, that's one nearly stretched out polymer. Here's another state of a polymer. Here's another state of the polymer. Which is more likely? The answer is, in the absence of any other information, they're all equally likely, but there are so many more states where it's all crumpled up. So even though there's no added energy into the system, it's in thermodynamic equilibrium, this polymer is actually acting like a rubber band. So that's entropy doing work. All right, so we'll get back to that in a second. So what we see is from Boltzmann is that the second law describes the property of large numbers. That when you take something and it just in a closed system evolves, what you're doing is you're just seeing it go to more likely states. And if there are many, many states, the most likely states look to be one state when averaged over many things. So this looks pretty obvious. But why the second law describes the properties of large numbers, okay, then it must be true. That's what Einstein and Eddington figured out before they knew deeply what this meant. But why the universe obeys the laws of mathematics, let's say the common notions of Euclid, is a deep question, and you should think about it. We weren't given the laws of mathematics on stone tablets from some mountain. And one of my favorite movies is a movie called Lincoln by Steven Spielberg. And in it, Abraham Lincoln is agonizing about equality of man, and he's talking about the notions of Euclid, which Lincoln studied as a young man. He said, things which are equal to the same thing are equal to each other. That's a rule of mathematical reasoning. It's true because it works. It's an experimental fact. Okay? So, laws of large numbers are an experiment. That's my experimentalist version of this. all right, now, let me tell you about how this appears in biology. So, you're going to learn about some studies we did on so-called molecular motors. And in cells, you have to transport material. Not all material movement is by diffusion. And in things like neurons, which you have very, very long, slender axons, that's this long, skinny thing, these axons could extend many tens of nanometers to millimeters to actually about a meter. The longest axon in your body goes from your hip to your knee. So if you're tall, you're a meter. So you can't get there by diffusion. And molecules that are made in the body of the cell and other objects like mitochondria that create all the energy are transported down to the end of the cell. And then other molecules from other neurons are gobbled up, eaten by the cell at the tips of these axons and transported back to the cell body. So there's a two-way communication. The motors that do this, they have names. They're called kinesin and dynein. So this is going to be a study of a very complicated motor, one which we do not fully understand yet. And it's called dynein. It's in light and dark blue. This light and dark blue molecule is a single amino acid peptide chain that's 1.5 million hydrogen masses. It's a huge protein. It's all connected together, and all the pieces kind of talk to one another in some way that's being understood, but after many years, still not fully understood. So what are we going to do? We're going to try to study this motor, and the technique we're going to use has been inspired by the greatest American philosopher of the 20th century. In case you're wondering who that is, plays baseball for the New York Yankees, used to at least, played Yogi Berra. He said many wise things, and he said you can observe a lot by just watching. it's like, you know, it's coming, the Clausius is 200th anniversary. If you don't go to your friends' memorial services, they won't go to yours. It's also Yogi Berra. Okay. Anyway, so what we are going to do is we're going to use some new probes we developed in my lab, or improved upon. They're called upconverting nanoparticles. I don't want to go into the details, but these are ion impurities in a crystal, and they can be excited by infrared light, and a two-step excitation process, they can actually emit infrared light. And they have many nice properties. They're very photostable over many, many hours at the highest intensities. The gray is a quantum dot that blinks and finally photobleaches. And these other colors are dyes, fluorescent dyes, that photobleach very quickly. So these new particles actually enable us to track things for a long time. And we figured out how to grow these crystals with very high purity, but with much higher concentrations of the optically active elements. And so at intensities suitable for animal imaging, they're about 150, now 200 times brighter than previously reported particles. And at the intensities I'm going to show you, they're about 6 times brighter. So what are we going to do? We put these neurons in a little microfluidic cell we fabricate. And you grow these and induce them to grow their axons across this channel that's 5 microns wide. And over here, the distant axons, you put in your particles, you put a coating on them. The cells grab the particles, eat them up, because they think this chemical signal is something that they want to transport back to the cell body. So the cell is putting all the machinery on the cell, all the molecular motors, and we just simply look at them. And we look at them, but our particles enable us to look for many, many minutes over a journey of 900 microns. And so this is another view of the cell. This is some raw data. There's no cell fluorescence because we're using infrared light. And because these are very bright, you can actually see in much greater detail than you could see with quantum dots and certainly fluorescent particles. So this is an example. You see sometimes it loses track, goes the opposite way. Sometimes it really gets confused, goes in a different direction, goes on, hops on a different track. So imagine taking in a cell, a vesicle, going many tens of minutes over this nearly distance of nearly a millimeter. And then from that, you can discover things. So let's talk about what you can discover. Well, over a period of time, let's say seconds, this is really many minutes for the entire journey, but over seconds, you see that sometimes it kind of slows and stops and wonders what's going on, then continues on a journey, then does it at a different velocity and things like that. So we're going to just simply look at the statistics of this motion. How far does it move? And what's the spread in the movement? And so when you do that, for example, if you start at time t, and it's in this position over here at x, and after time t plus tau, it's over here, it's moved a certain distance, and you take that for this red, whole entire red segment from t equals 0 all the way up here, you find that at t equals 0, they all start here. After 10 milliseconds, some of the times it moves forward, sometimes it moves backwards. This is the histogram of all those motions of this constant velocity journey, just the red segment. At 40 milliseconds, 100 milliseconds, you see it looks kind of like a Gaussian, the histograms, and it just moves forward. And so you can describe the distribution in terms of an average mean displacement, mu, and the spread, sigma or s squared. Okay, so this is just displacement over the dispersion. And what we find in one vesicle is that sometimes it goes and it begins to asymptote towards a certain value of twice the displacement divided by the dispersion. Then it goes into another segment, it goes and does something again, and another segment goes. So these are all the segments of one vesicle over 900 microns. And it's asymptoting into three levels, 0.1, 0.2, 0.3. Not all of them times it asymptotes to this steady level. Sometimes it wanders around. So 40% of the time it kind of wanders around. But we're more interested in what happens when it reaches some steady state value and what this steady state value means. Why it doesn't do it all the time, we don't know. But nevertheless, that's one vesicle. We look at 12 vesicles. All the vesicles could be different. And one vesicle only has 2 states. Another vesicle has 3 states. This one has 3 states. Some of them have 5 states. These are different vesicles from the same set of cells. Okay. So what is going on here? Now, if you form a histogram of all these journeys, of all these states, you find that they're remarkably quantized. The units are 1 over length because it's the displacement divided by the dispersion, sigma squared. And it's 0.1, 0.2, 0.3. So the question is, what does this really mean? So let me just show you a very, very stupid, simple theory and of what this quantization means. We're going to say, suppose there are different motors, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 motors. And assume each motor, if it moves this vesicle, it after a certain time, there's a kind of Gaussian-shaped thing of a probability distribution. But let's assume the vesicles are attached to two motors, but the two motors don't talk to one another. They're not even attached to the same point on the vesicle. So when one motor wants to move the vesicle, the other one hasn't decided to do anything, so the vesicle moves maybe half the distance, okay? Because these motors are independent, after the certain time, the displacement probabilities, the x1 and x2 are how far they go, they're just independent variables. And we know from independent variables, if you have probability distributions, the combined probability distribution is a product of the two independent variables. Okay? So far, nothing up my sleeves. Okay? All right. Product of two variables. But, you know, those distributions kind of look Gaussian. So I say to myself, for Gaussian, I have an analytic solution. The product of two Gaussians is a Gaussian. The mean of the two Gaussians is the same. The dispersion is half. Why is the mean the same? Well, because you got two motors. Well, one motor walks, the other one doesn't. So you go half the distance. Another motor walks, the other one doesn't. You go half the distance. But you're going twice as many. So you go the same number of steps. Why is the dispersion less? Because you're taking smaller steps. Product of n Gaussians is the same. It's the dispersion goes down by 1 over n, and mu remains the same. So now, I have to confess, we submitted this paper to Science. We got this referee who says, you didn't prove anything. And I looked at that and said, that's not a proof, but never mind. But there's something more important than the proof, and that is experimental evidence, because we don't know how many motors there are, but you can go in vitro, and people have done this, they actually take a dyneema motor on a microtubule, and they put one motor on and see how fast it goes and what the dispersion is, mostly in this experiment, how fast it is. They put another motor tied to a piece of DNA, so when one motor works, the other one may or may not work, okay? And they go 1, 2, 3, 4 motors, and guess what? The velocity is the same. The velocity distribution of the in vitro experiments is broad, as is ours. So if you look at this, one motor, two motor, three motors, our data says the velocity is increasing by about 5-8%, but hardly at all. The in vitro experiment says it shouldn't have increased at all if they're independent motors, and our math says they shouldn't have increased at all because they're independent motors. Okay, so this is good. This is what we can get by looking a long distance, because we have so good statistics. What else can we learn? Well, the particles are very bright. In our particles, we can get 5 million counts a second in a live cell. This you cannot do with any other probe. If you use a quantum dot, you will fry the cell. If you use a fluorescent dye, you can see them for a fraction of a second, and then you're lost. You can't see it for minutes. But we can see individual molecular steps. And so we took measurements at 22C, 30C, and 37C. First question, how do you know this is one motor? I just explained we have 1, 2, 3, 4 motors. Again, we go back to in vitro experiments. This is our distribution of steps that we measure in our live neurons. This is the distribution of steps in vitro measurements made of a dyneema dimer. But there's only one motor. They look kind of the same. In fact, there are more recent experiments. They all lay on top of one another. The only difference is we're in a totally different regime because we have orders of magnitude better time resolution. Okay? But so we think we have one motor. But there's something more because we can vary the temperature. What is our different regime? Our different regime is that the amount of fuel powering our motor is roughly 3 millimolar ATP. In those other steps, the data I just showed you, it was 4 micromolar. Why 4 micromolar? Because they were using quantum dots and probes, And so they lower the rate so they can see single steps. And so the question is, can you see something different when you're three orders of magnitude higher ATP? And the answer is yes. And so what we find is that the time between steps, the so-called dwell time, and so how do we decide what's between steps? It's a standard package of a Markov determination. When does it take a step? How big is the step? So this is all automated. This is not a graduate student or postdoc artfully trying to fit data. And so what we see is we see a rise and a fall of histogram of the dwell times. And the black lines are is a very simple fit to the following type of idea. Suppose the motor requires two processes before it completes a full cycle. So if one process is described by a simple rate constant, that means the probability of it occurring is just a single exponential decay, like this red line. But after that event occurs, it has to go through another rate constant step, given by its blue line. The way you find out what the dwell time is, you just take the convolution of those two curves. So that's just the math over here. And it turns out, from K1 is equal to K2, you can trivially show that. If you're good in algebra, you can show that, or you can Google the answer. Anyway, you can find that this is the function, and it fits very well to these functions. Okay, so it's two rate constants in a totally different regime. But they're thermally activated, because as you go to higher temperature, the thing gets narrower, okay? So that's an important clue. Why is that important? And we have the times. Why is it an important clue? The motor is going to be powered by ATP. So that means there's an empty site somewhere in the enzyme. ATP lands. It immediately hydrolyzes. It makes it ATP. Three phosphates goes to ADPPI. So the phosphate bond is broken. That's ATP goes to ADPPI. Then the PI thermally leaves, it goes to ADP. And finally, the ADP thermally leaves, and it goes to the empty state. But when we looked up the rates of all these things, we found that at 3 millimolar concentration, the time it takes for ATP to land in the cell is about a millisecond. But our delay times are 144 milliseconds for room temperature, going down to 21 milliseconds at 37 degrees. So that's too fast. This concentration of ATP is too fast. At the in vitro concentrations of 4 micromolar and 12 micromolar, this is the rate limiting step. So the landing of ATP on the enzyme hit everything else. Okay, that's very important. ATP goes to ADPPI. That's hydrolysis that's known to occur much less than a millisecond. ADP to APOL, independently measured, also occurred to be less than a millisecond. So there are 4 rates. All of them are less than a millisecond except one, the thermal desorption of PI. But there are 2 rates. So that means there must be 2 active ATP sites per step. You're forced to this conclusion. Okay? Now, that led us to, over the next 3 years, to read all the literature and construct a very detailed molecular model looking at all the structural biology, all the cryo-EM, all this. But I'm going to spare you that because I want to get to the nonlinear stat mech and back to Clausewitz. Okay. But we got very quantitative. I'm scared of the structural stuff. But for example, these are the histograms that we've measured at 22, 30, and 37 degrees. Don't look at the blue dotted lines, that's just to guide the eye, but look at just the measured quantities, the histograms. And the black line is a Gaussian fit. Now, you see there's an absence here, but I have to tell you, there's a limitation to our experiment, just as there were limitations to the in vitro experiments. We could not see steps smaller than about 8 nanometers. Neither did any of the eventual guys going at much lower rates. Okay? There could be occurring, but we don't see them. They're hidden in the noise. You know, there's Brownian motion noise and Brownian motion noise. But there's something about it, if you look at this fit and put it in a Gaussian set, realizing that you don't see the really small stuff, that the centers of the Gaussians are the same and the width just shrinks. Okay? So I was looking at the data when I showed this stuff to Ron Vail, who did the first seminal pioneering experiments. He looked at the seed diagram and says, wow, they don't take backward steps. Well, they don't take many backward steps, but the really impressive thing was the width was narrowing, but the center was exactly the same spot. Okay, so, you know, I'm a physicist, so you say, okay, we know how to model this. You know, we have these two motors with these two legs, and one goes this way, and this one goes, and this is the cargo, and my legs are the two motors, and this one goes like this, and this one goes like this, and the, you know, the guy moves. But this guy is connected to the two legs by some simple elastic spring. It's all on molecular scale, so it's overdamped. And so it's a diffusion, an overdamped diffusion. And that is a differential equation you can solve that says statistically the x squared average, statistical average of x squared is given by 2k over the spring constant times this quantity over here. The amazing thing about this is that you can extract a spring constant, that's a parameter, but the same width of the measurements fit single parameters over here. So these are at 22 degrees, 22 degrees, 30 degrees, 37 degrees. It fits the same one, and we say that the legs are diffusing around before it takes a step, and we can use the rates of diffusion of when it takes a step and when it moves. And all this stuff, and how far does it diffuse? Well, we know the size of the molecule, the dynein. We know the viscosity. Therefore, we know how much it diffuses. The only three parameters are spring constant. And that all the sizes, the molecular sizes, also fit. So we know, we're pretty sure that it's this very simple sort of thing. But let me go back to the thermodynamics. It's very interesting because we know we have one motor. We can look up what the free energy is for ATP being converted to ADP. So the before is ATP, the after is ADP and PI separated. And we find that the hydrolysis of one ATP is a certain number of joules per ATP. And if you put in Kelvin units, it's about 12K. Okay. All right, we know the viscosity, we know the size of the cargo, we know the viscosity, we know on average how fast it's moving. And so from that, we can know what the mechanical work is. That is to say, the mechanical work of dragging the vesicle through the axon. And we find that for the highest velocity, it's given like this. You do a little bit more simple mathematics, and you define the motor efficiency as the mechanical work used to move this vesicle divided by the chemical energy, and it's at least 45%, plus or minus 20%. Well, that's pretty good. That's better than a diesel engine. This isn't, and guess what? It's all at the same temperature. And of course, it's not a surprise because this is not a thermal engine. It's a chemical engine. And if you have a chemical bond and you orient a chemical bond and you decide to cut it very nicely, in principle, you might say, why isn't it 100% efficient? Think about an electrical motor, not a heat engine. Electricity to mechanical, 98% efficient. Okay? Now, we don't know what the efficiency is, but you can now do an experiment because you can put in vitro very high viscosity, and you cheat, just like in a cell. You put in particles that allow the ATP to move in out very rapidly, but they're bumping other particles that create a viscous drag on the vesicle. And you just want to do that until it can no longer step. So the notion of energy efficiency is a little bit tricky. If you have a Ferrari, and it's supposed it's 500 horsepower, but you're on an Autobahn going 60 miles an hour, its efficiency is very bad, right? It's just not good. But if you're the same Ferrari going from 100 kilometers an hour to 200 kilometers an hour very fast in 1 second, it's pretty good, okay? So the efficiency depends on the motor. People before tried to measure the efficiency of motors by taking an optical tweezer in vitro, hanging onto the attached motor, and then dragging, but it's no good. Because when people use optical tweezers, they have to remember to read the user's manual. What's the user's manual? You have two steps. I'm lifting my leg and stepping, but I'm pulling on this. When I'm stepping, I'm not actually stroking and pulling the power, so it's more likely to pull away. When the motor is moving, it's got both feet firmly planted, then it moves. Okay, so measuring optical tweezers, what the stopping force is not, it's the ripping off force, is not the right force. Measuring under actual load is the right force. But let's continue. I want to tell you a little bit about, more about motors. And I want to turn to Schrödinger, what Schrödinger said in his lectures in 1944. From all that we've learned about the structure of living matter, we must be prepared to find it working in a manner that cannot be reduced to the ordinary laws of physics, not because there's any new force, but because the construction is different from anything we've yet tested in the physical laboratory. Well, this is my interpretation of what he was talking about. Imagine you're Isaac Newton, the size of a bacteria, but still Isaac Newton's brain, and his laws of motion would be very different. Archimedes would be right. There is no inertia. It's you stop pushing or pulling, an object immediately comes to rest. And so there's no net motion, but there's some unseen hand of God or something jiggling you for some reason you haven't understood. And so to reiterate, F does not equal ma. In the case of an overdamped system, the force of drag force is just equal to proportional to the velocity. Okay. So in a living world, these machines work embedded in a viscous fluid. So friction and thermal fluctuations are huge. And this motor is incredibly clever. I, again, don't want to go into this, but there's more exciting things to talk about. But very, very clever. It's using fluctuations to move it most of the way, and it decides to lock it in place and make something irreversible while it's moved in this direction. So it's actually using the fluctuations to get most of the motion. Because when ATP binds on the molecule, there's only nanometer, sub-nanometer motions, and yet it's stepping by 10 nanometer steps. So it's a very, very good machine. Okay, so let's talk about the statistical physics. To that, I'm gonna go back and remind you about statistical mechanics and physics. Consider two molecules, they're colliding, time is going upward, and they just bounce off. Reverse the movie, the two molecules come, collide, and bounce off. Looks great, you can't tell which way is forward, backward in time. Imagine taking a drop of blue ink, dropping it in a beaker, and all of a sudden the blue molecules can kind of average around, and after a while they diffuse around, and the most likely place you'll find the ink molecules is anywhere in the beaker. Okay, why? Because entropy tells you that's the most likely accessible state. So where the average is the average, okay? So this gives you an arrow of time. You know which way the movie is going. There's a new theorem, relatively new, only discovered in the 1990s, numerically, and then proven a year later. And it has to do with the flow of entropy. And it says the probability of entropy flow going forward in time, that's this movie, divided by the probability of entropy flow going backward in time, that means all the blue molecules coming back into the drop, go exponentially likely to go forward in time, and it quantifies this law of large numbers. So let me say this again. So this fluctuation theorem tells you if you follow one trajectory of this molecule, of all these molecules, the likelihood of it going backward in time goes exponentially small. If you take a particle, a micron-sized particle, and just drop it in very still air, it falls. It's out of thermal equilibrium, it's falling, but it can fall upward because it's in contact with a reservoir, so it goes up the other way. So this has been discovered, as I said, numerically proved, known actually in thermal equilibrium, but this is true no matter what, whether you're in or out of equilibrium, because it's another law of large numbers. All right, so this is a little bit of history of how it was discovered, and we're not violating the second law. The second law is about equilibrium. So now we're talking about transitions, all right? And, okay, so that's the fluctuation theorem. Probability going forward in time, or reverse in time. Going forward in time is you're moving from the distant axon back to the cell body. Going back in time, you're moving in the opposite direction. All right, so you construct it algebraically. So you consider two paths, a red and a green path. This is one time it's walking up, and another time it's walking up. So the time reverse thing is you just go backward in time, and so you can generate the probability of going in the opposite direction just algebraically. And the beautiful thing about that is if they're exponentials, going backward in time and going forward in time, the division, you take the logarithm, that you're subtracting the stuff in the exponents, and you can construct this. So this is the same math all over again, except now it's due to entropy flow. Okay? So this is exactly what we did. It's the same thing as Gaussian. If it's Gaussian approximation, taking the log of two Gaussians is subtracting the stuff in the exponents, and it's after a certain amount of time, it's the change in the entropy with Boltzmann's constant because temperature should have been in joules instead of degrees Kelvin, but never mind. It's a long story. So in any case, this is our phi again. Twice displacement over this, except now, using the fluctuation theorem, it's related to a thermodynamic quantity, okay? All right, so you go back to the thermodynamics, and the change in the heat is T times delta S, which is equal to the enthalpy times the work, but in the cycle of the enzyme, the full cycle of the enzyme, this enzyme, the motor returns back to the same state, so delta H is zero per step. So it's just the work done. Plug in the thing. Now we're using the fluctuation theorem to get relate entropy to work related to force is equal to force over kT. Use the same stuff all over again, 37 degrees. We know what it is. We plug in all these numbers, and we find that the drag force is 0.43 piganewtons. The only trouble is that's not a good answer because we know what the viscosity of the vesicle is in the cell. We know the speed, and we're finding the drag force is not 0.43, it's like 2.5 piconewtons or higher. It's 2.5 piconewtons for 1 micron, so it's 6 microns, much higher, okay? So something is screwy. So what's wrong? You go back and you look at the math, you check it, you reread what you did. Did I misinterpret it? No. No, so what could happen? Well, if this temperature is not the temperature of the cell, but it's a higher temperature, just pretend, and if it's 5.7% times higher than 310 Kelvin, that's 37 degrees, then you get the right value. Okay, so what does it mean to be higher in temperature? Well, that turns out to be an interesting idea. So again, take you back in history. In 1931-32, Lars Anzager dared to step out of equilibrium thermodynamics and statistical physics. And he said, suppose you take a thermal system, and put it out of thermal equilibrium, just a little bit out of thermal equilibrium. The way this system returns back to thermal equilibrium is related to the fluctuations about equilibrium. So he called this the regression hypothesis. Gets a Nobel Prize for this conjecture later shown decades later. In hindsight, was it that surprising? Why? Because if you're in thermal equilibrium and you have a huge, humongous fluctuation, 2 or 3 sigma out, could you really know whether it's been out of thermal equilibrium? It wasn't really, it was just at a fluctuation out here and it regresses to the norm, or you put it out there. So in a certain sense, it had to be right. It's always true after you understand it, it had to be right. Intuition is always honed by knowing the answer. So So what Ansager said is it's the fluctuations at equilibrium related to how it returns to equilibrium. Okay? Now, since that time, it was shown that that is true not only a little bit out of equilibrium, it's true way out of equilibrium. And another way of looking at it is follow Ansager and say, you know, you look at a correlation in position. It's a position here, a little while later it's a position here. After a while, it's lost correlation where it used to be. And that is related to what is making it change position, some integrated force, integrated response of the system. And in thermal equilibrium, temperature is this parameter that's the ratio of the correlation function divided by the response function. Okay, so what does K out of your equilibrium really mean? So when I started doing this, it's very complicated. The math is complicated. Theorists like to make life complicated. But let me also show you that it was experimentally demonstrated with an analog experiment. And that is, some people took an optical tweezer and a bead and just jiggled it. And they jiggled a certain rate. And they showed if you jiggle at fast enough rate, it can reach some steady state. And the steady state can be characterized with being the same sort of Ansager stuff. The correlation function divided by the integrated response reaches a constant. So after a certain time, you reach a constant, and it's out of equilibrium, meaning it's not the effective temperature. So let me take the mystery out of what this really means. Because when I think of equilibrium and temperature, I think of equipartition theorem, for example. For each degree of freedom, you've got 1/2 mv squared, 1/2 kt, something like that. So let's take F equals ma, the Langevin equation, mass times the acceleration, and look at all the forces on this vesicle. There's the motor, there's the drag force, the viscous drag, and there's Brownian motion. That's this thing. But I can divide the motor into two parts, a steady state average thing and a stochastic part of the motor. This motor doesn't walk like in step, lockstep, but it has a stochastic nature and a viscous drag. And now I'm going to do something really simple. You go to the frame of reference of the vesicle. So in the frame of reference of the vesicle, the motor, it looks like a steady state thing, and it cancels the viscous drag. And what you're left with is some relaxation about the center mass velocity times two random terms, the motor term and the Brownian motion term. If those two terms are two noise terms, now, what do we know about the Brownian motion? If you look at the correlation between the Brownian motion, they're uncorrelated. In one moment in time, you've got a force over here. Another moment in time, the force is over here. They're uncorrelated. The correlation time in a fluid is like 10 to the minus 14 seconds. The motor's not jiggling 10 to the minus 14 seconds. It's jiggling every 10 milliseconds, 20 milliseconds. But if you wait 3 or 4 steps, there's no longer a correlation between what it did here and what it did here. Okay. So in this funny, when do you recover back the delta function over here? It's because you have to recover a delta function to average on over this number of steps. But what is different about this? The motor is very powerful. So when the motor decides to step, it can move this big vesicle a big distance. But in the frame of reference of the vesicle, it looks like it's a random shot. Okay? So it looks like another noise term. Okay? But because the motor is powerful, it can do this. So if the motor operates with fast enough steps, it looks like another noise term if you average over a long enough period of time. That's essentially what effective temperature means in this case. It reaches a steady state. And so its other Brownian motion term is just bigger by sixfold. Okay, that's good. But there's something else that's even, you know, so you say, what's the big deal? Well, apparently it has become a big deal because it explains glasses, icy models, stuff like that, as well as biological motors in life. Biological motors in vitro don't step fast enough. It has to step fast enough. So we now know necessary fishing conditions are out of equilibrium, but there's something even cooler. And it goes back to the fluctuation theorem. This idea was first proposed by Bradley and Seifert, but not proven by them, and it was later shown that it's a result of the fluctuation theorem, but it's doing the same math. And when you take a step, and then you take another step, and another step, the sum of all those steps are just the convolution of each probability step function. So I was doing this a couple years ago and said, well, if they're Gaussians, and you take the convolution of Gaussians, it's also a Gaussian, but it doesn't have to be the convolution of many probability density functions that are integrable become Gaussian. Okay. So the normalized dispersion becomes this. Normalized dispersion is the spread, n sigma squared, and n is the number of steps. And what you can show from the fluctuation theorem is t times delta s after a certain time times how orderly the steps are is equal to 2kt if it's Gaussian. And if it's anything but Gaussian, it's bigger than 2kt. So it's an uncertainty principle. So let me say it again. Delta q times how orderly this thing works, it's got to be greater than or equal to 2kt, a result of a fluctuation theorem. It's a result not of how this engine works or the motor works or any other process works. It's just the trade-off between order and energy and temperature, okay? That means if you take a Mickey Mouse watch, a quartz watch, it's good to a second a day. And it's got a precision of 100 times greater than that. The precision requires 6 times 10 minus 9 joules. It's not a lot of energy. But it's the thermodynamic limit due to entropy, which is a really cool thing. Think about that. It's just like Landauer's thing. Landauer's thing was related to the entropy of reading out and resetting a bit of memory. So here's this idea of entropy taking on a whole new deeper meaning. Now, this limit of Landauer's was accepted. It was said, wow, that was really cool. But more recently, it said, no. Landauer was assuming statistical thermal equilibrium. But computation is not thermal equilibrium. When you read out a bit, you've done something irreversible except in the United States. Why is the United States different? Because you can get some information and the president of the United States says, no, it's the other thing. So, former president of the United States. But when you have it could be a 0 or 1 and you find it's a 0 or 1 and then you reset it, that's irreversible. So the fundamental premise was beginning to be realized what can't not be equilibrium thermodynamics. The fundamental premise of how anything operates in life cannot be equilibrium thermodynamics, because you're taking chemical energy and you're converting it into other stuff. Information, DNA, all this stuff is non-equilibrium. Okay? So, this is amazing. So, in a review article I found, he talks about Landauer and the limit, and he says, the research by Landauer and co-workers was done when non-equilibrium statistical physics was still in its infancy, requiring them to rely on equilibrium statistical physics. Since then, there have been major breakthroughs in non-equilibrium statistical physics in the last 15 or 20 years, leading in particular to a new subfield of, quote, stochastic thermodynamics. These breakthroughs have allowed us to put thermodynamic analysis of bit erasure on a fully formal non-equilibrium footing. And similarly with biological stuff. It's fundamentally non-equilibrium, but what rules? Entropy. So before I leave entropy, I just want to remind you that when we grow and do things and learn, we're becoming more ordered. We're doing lots of irreversible things, but the system, the living organism, us, in this case Pigpen, and the rest of the Earth is a closed system, so entropy is conserved. And so what we do is we leave a debris of disorder behind. And humans are the world's best at leaving huge trails of entropy. Let me return back to Clausius. This is one of my favorite pictures. It was taken on Apollo 8, the first thing that orbited the moon, and the astronaut who took this picture, you look at this beautiful Earth, bleak lunar landscape, and he said, we came all this way to explore the moon. The most important thing is we've discovered the Earth. If you look at this picture, this is a really good place to live. This is not a good place to live. No water, no air, no magnetic fields, everything like that. So let me return back to Clausius and his, what I understand is his rector's address they gave in 1885. And he was talking about the increased coal consumption. He said, we consume now and thereby act like lightning heirs consuming a rich legacy. We gather as much as possible from the earth and we consume it as if it were inexhaustible. The following centuries will have the task of introducing a wise economy in the use of what the sources of power in nature offers us, namely renewable energy, especially of not squandering the wastefully what we find in the soil, the coal, the fossil fuel, as a legacy of earlier times. The successful execution of such a measure requires the cooperation of so many nations that it may seem impossible to view of the competing interests of various people. But he ends by saying, in these endeavors, one may well hope that this question, so important for the future welfare of mankind, can also be led, at least gradually, towards a common solution. So, happy anniversary to Clausius.
Thank you. Thank you, Professor Chu, for that very nice talk leading us from molecular mortars to statistical physics. And we have time for a couple of questions, scientific questions. And I would be so, I forgot the English word, sorry, I would start asking questions.
Yeah.
When I heard your talk, and you also addressed the problems humankind create. So I was thinking about two people here from the University of Bonn, Elvira Maas and Oldamor Holotsky, who studied nanoplastics. And Oldamor simulated nanoplastics and he could show that it alters biological systems or biochemical systems. So I was wondering, would that be also a target for your measurements and also for your model?
Well, first, the idea of plastics. We don't actually want biodegradable plastics because biodegradable plastics means you take carbon out of the ground, you use it once, you throw it away, and it becomes methane. Worst possible fate. You want to recycle as much as possible. Mm. The reason, though, is of concern is because it's very polluting, and when you do break down, they actually break down these microplastics, and that ends up in organisms and all of it. And so the whole plastic industry, so I talk to people at BASF, and I also, I also advise Shell. I advise them because they want to make a transition. They have to be out of the fossil business in 30 or 40, 50 years for sure. And they don't know how to make this transition. Most of the plastics we use are not recyclable. Mm-hmm. Okay, so that's a really hard chemistry problem to do that. If you have organically made kind of plastic equivalents, you can do that, but it's the cost is, you buy ethylene by the ton, dollar per ton. and so you can't do that. But it's a non-trivial chemistry problem, but you can start by stop using, use once, throw away. and do that. But then to measure how you get that and actually have the final degradation, biology's figured out how to do this, but the chemists have not because, petroleum and natural gas has given us such cheap chemistry that it's dominated everything for 130 years. So
there's still
so it's
ahead.
A very that's a very difficult question, and it's certainly worth working on.
Mm-hmm. So are there further questions? I have a couple of more. Ah, yeah, over here. So please speak to the microphone that the stream also hears you.
Very nice talk, Steve. One question, you showed this dissipation theorem in the non-equilibrium case. I understood that normally in non-equilibrium cases, as for a laser, one does not get a universal temperature in a non-equilibrium case. But you're saying there are systems where universal temperature does exist. Also,
it's a very special case of steady state. So remember when this motor is going and it reaches this plateau? So then all of a sudden the displacement divided by the dispersion is reaching steady state. Mm-hmm. And the requirement for steady state is you have time reversal invariance. Mm-hmm. Equilibrium, you can't tell the difference in time going forward and backward. So that means if you block up what's happening in segments of time, right, they're uncorrelated. Mm-hmm. And so in this uncorrelated segments of time, because equilibrium is infinity, so I was very careful to say approaching equilibrium, once you have this steady state time reversal invariance, then you get this, okay? But in general, it's not. You're not in thermal equilibrium. There is no temperature. There is no parameter like temperature. But once you're in this funny business of this fluctuation dissipation reaching steady state, then you have this. And then it becomes very simple. So my very simple move to the frame of reference, mm-hmm. when you're moving the frame of reference and displacement divided by dispersion is constant, mm-hmm. then you've reached steady state. You know, after you average over a few steps, you can't tell whether you're going forward and backward. So it begins to look like equilibrium, and you expect equal partition theorem and all those things. Okay, but the really important thing I'm going to stress, in my opinion, is the fluctuation theorem, which is general no matter where you reach steady state or not, and it gives you things like uncertainty principles, which says no matter how smart you are, if you want more order, you have to pay for it.
This was news to me, yes.
Yeah, that's a very nice theorem. It's only in the last couple of years, 5 years.
Okay.
So there's something new in statistical physics. But Clausius was right. Entropy is the king.
I think due to the advanced time, we stop here. And okay. We have later again time for discussion. But now we come to the last point, to our panel, where we want to discuss a little bit, a couple of questions. And I would like to ask Jean-Marie Len and Dieter Meschede and Peter Föhringer and Johannes Orphal to the stage. Maybe you go more in the middle. Yeah. Ich glaube, er hat sich ein Wasser geholt. Ja, genau. So in addition, we have now here Johannes Orphal from KIT Karlsruhe over here. And this is Peter Föhringer, the reason why I said Peter Meschede. Okay, so we want to have a short panel discussion. And we thought about three short questions which should be discussed, and this will be more lightly. So the first keyword would be interdisciplinarity. And if we are looking again at our TRAS, and I hope Peter Föhringer will say a word to it later, we can say that research is often, it's often important that we are not only having a narrow view, but that we work, and we saw you both working in a very transdisciplinary way. So my first question would be to Johannes Orfall, was this in earlier time more the case? Because when we hear about the people from earlier time, it's not clear, are they physicists or chemists or mathematicians? So was this more tradition to be educated in a broad way in earlier times than it is nowadays? It switches on by itself.
Oh, it switches on myself. It does. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So I'm not from history or physics. I'm actually a physicist, and I work on climate science and that stuff. But I worked a lot on Clausius, and I want to illustrate it by Clausius' early life as a student in Berlin, because I started looking at this time when I was myself a student, and I was very fascinated. Clausius, when he came to Berlin, wanted to study history, and he heard lectures by Leopold von Ranke. And he was also very well educated in philosophy. And you can find traces of that when he argues in, for example, his famous paper in 1850 about the two laws of thermodynamics. Just to come back a little bit to the last talk on this aspect of intuition that you know the result somehow. Clausius was convinced that both Carnot's idea that heat goes from a hot to a cold reservoir in order to produce heat must be right, because that is what's happening in a steam engine. But he was also convinced that Joule's theory must be right, because that was also true from experiment. And so he was, by his logical reasoning, convinced that if experiment is right, both theories or both hypotheses must be right. And this is how he found this solution, because they had to be right. And so it is what you said, the result was there. It was not just pure intuition also. And the second thing that is important in Clausius' early life is that he discovered what you said, Monsieur Lehn, that mathematical laws is what rules the universe. So he found the power of mathematics, which actually was then his contribution to physics in a way, because he was so convinced that mathematics rules physics in a way, and he learned it from Dirichlet, that when he could formulate this in terms of mathematics, he found, you know, the truth. And that is very, very interesting. And very often then he proposed experiments and that stuff. And now to make it not too long, he studied with Gustav Magnus. And Gustav Magnus was a student of Berzelius. So Magnus was a chemist. Yeah, but Clausius somehow decided to go to physics, and I think he was inspired by Magnus. So in Clausius' time, there was a big mixture of disciplines then, and we are still a product of this. Look, for example, when we had this discussion this morning about physics or chemistry for your institute, or we have discussions, experimental or theoretical physics here in Germany. I mean, Steve Chu, you are a theorist and you are an experimentalist. And when people here would say you are an experimentalist because you have touched lasers and optical tweezers, yeah. But you do a lot of theory, as we saw. And I think the interdisciplinarity that we are discussing now is a result of the disciplines that emerged 150 years ago or so, but they are not defined by nature or so. And Clausius is a very good example. When you go through logics, philosophy, mathematics, physics, to chemistry, and then even to the universe. Thank you.
Thank you. Maybe to the Nobel laureates, how was it for you? When I read about your biography, then I saw that you were very interdisciplinary. So did you plan this, or did you just... Yeah. It switches on.
No, I didn't plan anything. Or I think mathematics doesn't rule. Mathematics represents, describes, but doesn't rule.
I think mathematics is experimentally observed rules. I will reiterate that.
I wouldn't exactly agree with that.
But I believe in my heart it must be true. If A equals B and B equals C, how can A not equal C, right? It's a Euclid notion.
But that's not mathematics, it's reasoning.
But that's, and they said that's logic. And you say, well, where did the logic come
logic.
From? And where did logic come from? Observation. Anyway, no, I didn't plan either my career. My advisor wanted me to work on only the most fundamental problems in physics, symmetries, things like that. And so for my thesis and postdoc, I worked on trying to verify the weak, electrical weak theory using lasers and an experimental approach that Bouchias proposed. And so then when I started doing other things, for example, laser cooling trapping, he said, what are you doing that for? You're wasting your life. That's not fundamental physics. And I said, yes, it's not. It's applied quantum mechanics. but it turned out to be useful. It's all up by accident. I mean, I just kind of followed my nose.
Peter, maybe you want to add something?
Yeah, I think, first of all, I should say these were two beautiful talks, and I think what they documented tonight is, that you can really advance science when you look across your classical disciplines. And so I've, for example, Jean-Marie, if I look at your talk, you're moving into medicine, yeah, with chemistry. And I think, it's at the interface between chemistry and the life sciences where you can really find true innovations. And I think it's so important. I'm not going to say that innovation can only be found between the classical disciplines, but I think they can be found very likely in this region. And this was, of course, one of the reasons why we have here in Bonn the transdisciplinary research areas. Yeah, so they are supposed to be, and the rector can do this much better than me, they're supposed to serve as platforms where we can think beyond that what we've learned in, when we were graduate students. Yeah. And I think that's something we should make use of. We have these structures at universities, and it brings you together with people who think a little bit different. Maybe they even speak a different language. And so we adapt to our partners, and that's when normally, under normal conditions, innovation starts to emerge. And I think we should make use of that. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But we have to be very careful not to sit between two chairs. Because each of our domains has also a core, and it's very good to have an open mind for trying to take up many different aspects from different areas, but we have to be careful not to talk about something which other people know better. So it's a complicated situation. Where interdisciplinarity is exactly sitting between two chairs often.
Yes, but I think, I mean it more in terms of installing collaborations where people bring in their expertise, but they work somewhere at the crossroads between the classical disciplines. And I think, every individual scientist should, bring in his or her strength, the expertise. But if you combine it with expertise of other, scientists in different fields, that's when I'm convinced this is where innovation really emerges. Yeah.
Yeah, or maybe you can help where others cannot help, in that way. Peter Meschert or Stephen Chu.
On which aspect now?
On the interdisciplinarity.
On the interdisciplinarity. Yeah, I think, I was thinking of myself, and I probably have focused on few areas in physics, but what I see at the present time, in a certain sense pressing, is that most of the interesting problems are gaining in complexity also. And I think complexity requires complex answers or so, and physicists just by themselves will not be able to answer these, and they need to go into other fields. One field actually which I find is a bit missed out, here and is also a legacy of Clausius, is the question of information. I think the question, and that touches both of your fields, of course. You mentioned it with the Landauer limit and so on. And so the question, how do we really deal with this abstract concept of information in this this situation? And I think this is something that Jean-Marie said, chemistry is the music for, and physics just provides the acoustic backlaws or so. I think especially this aspect of information brings something very new and beyond physics and chemistry. And this is something that we should take serious, and it will bring new innovation again.
The other thing I want to stress is that science advances usually by some new method, new technique, new way of measuring. And when you have a new technique, a new way of measuring, then you see things you didn't see before. And then all of a sudden, you begin to see new things. And so that's true of many, many things, from climate science and all those things. This is, in the end, it's measurement. And measurement can then validate very complex mathematical models, but in the end, it's going to be measurement and better measurements and more confidence that we can probably have in the what might happen. We can't afford to wait 50 or 100 years.
Yes, Peter. Yeah, if we said everything to that topic, maybe we turn to a topic which is kind of related to what you said, that science should have no borders. And we thought about how can science communicate important messages to society? We figure out something, and maybe it's not important, but maybe it's important and has consequences for society. So we were wondering, how can we make it the communication easier for scientists or for the public, so to say? And I think you both are very good experts or very excellent experts in talking to the public. So maybe you can tell us from your experience what scientists can learn to communicate better.
This is very hard, especially if it's laced with political things like climate change. But one tries to first talk about measurements, but then you can explain in very simple terms things like, for example, the greenhouse gas effect is easy to explain to people in a certain sense, right? They know what your car gets hot, you know, the sunlight goes in the window. That's easily understood. And so the thing that's hard to understand, harder to understand is why, as it gets warmer, why you have more evaporation, that the precipitation, there's going to be more precipitation because there's more evaporation, but it's going to be more uneven. And that's a little bit harder, right? But that drier places get drier, wetter places get wetter, and when it rains, it pours more, and things like that. That's more difficult to understand. But the fact that we've been seeing this in the last decade or two is saying, no. And the climate models predict this. But I think part of the reason why they gave a Nobel Prize in physics, a very odd one in a certain sense, that we can more deeply understand complex systems. So to climate scientists and to nonlinear thermodynamic type people. And so that's another thing, this appreciation that this complex things are possible to understand. And indeed, we have to understand them.
Now, the thing you mentioned, this climate change. People forget that water vapor is much more than CO2 compound, which contributes to climate change. Now, the cycle of vapor is, of course, a very short one compared to the cycle of CO2, but one has to take that into account. And I think one should be careful not to bet on the wrong horse. CO2 is certainly important, but we also have to worry about the other gases. Now, I want to come back to your beginning question. For me, communication of science, of course, is important, and we can do that. Some are better communicators than others. Unzager was a very bad communicator, but a very great scientist. It does not go in parallel. You can be a very bad communicator, be a very great scientist. I think the number one thing is that we have to do science, and we are, first of all, responsible for truth, and then only to society. I have not this position that we have responsibility to society first. We have it, but as scientists, we have first responsibility to trying to knowledge and to truth.
Yeah, we have to have something to report about, yeah.
Can so I respectfully disagree with my friend here? you're right, water vapor is a bigger greenhouse gas. It's much more subtle. High clouds and low clouds have different effects. And if you look at the climate studies and the IPCC reports that are the meta studies, the biggest uncertainty has to do with vapor. But the one thing that there's very little disagreement among those who have studied this is that water vapor is considered a follower. The temperature goes up, there's more water vapor, more clouds, there's more this. Whereas CO2 in this case is not a follower anymore. It might have been and probably was a follower in previous times when the climate changed. But this time, it's not a follower because of isotopic evidence, the carbon-14 evidence, that the increase in carbon dioxide has to have been from carbon deep underground sequestered where there's no more carbon-14. So it's considered, because of that, it's the driver and the water vapor is the follower. Previously, it was a follower. When it warms up, there's more CO2 organic. So, but you're spend your career on this.
No, I mean, it's very hard to talk after you about climate, even though I'm from the field, but the communication of climate change, I mean, of course, if you say you work on that, you are requested all the time to talk to policymakers and to society. And fortunately, we have the IPCC. I just want to mention that. And the IPCC is there to formulate the truth. It's the best way that we have found to formulate. And I know these people. I'm not in the IPCC, but I know this. I know Valérie Masson-Delmotte, for example. And I find it very convincing how they prepare for us. We are just the scientists, but we have to talk to our political parties here in Germany. Next week, I will be on the Assembly of all cities of Baden-Württemberg, and they invite me to talk there, and I cannot refuse. I must go there because it's my duty as a scientist also to communicate that. And then I have to be very careful. I have to be very careful that I communicate about what we know and also about the uncertainties. I think that is a very important thing today, because in particular with climate change, but also we had seen this with COVID, for example, because it makes people very frustrated if they don't understand what the truth is. And so there starts also some doubts about the validity of science if the communication is not right. And this is very difficult nowadays. I wanted to come back for a very short minute to Clausius' way to communicate to the public, because that is something interesting. Clausius is said to that he was a shy person who did not like to communicate also with other people, which is not true. He has written thousands of letters and so, but he did also public communication, and at the time that was no obligation. So when he went to the Zürich Naturforschende Gesellschaft or the Niederrheinische Gesellschaft and he talked about entropy and that stuff, he did it because I think he wanted to communicate his results to the public, which is very interesting. So he was really a visionary also in this aspect, because there was no societal pressure. I just wanted to mention that because it's really surprising. And his most important communications that contain no formula, he printed them in order to be accessible to everybody. So it's very impressive at that time, because nowadays we have this obligation as scientists, but I agree with Monsieur Lin that we don't have to communicate first, of course not.
Let me give you another example. My colleague at the Collège de France was Claude Lévi-Strauss, an anthropologist of very, very high level. He never wanted to give a general public lecture because he always said it distorts what I thought. So there are the two aspects. We have to communicate, but it's very difficult to talk another language. And so when we communicate to a very broad public, it's always unprecise. You don't communicate what we think is correct. So even if somebody like Levi-Strauss, who is, was a human scientist, he was not a hard scientist, as it said, it raises questions. This being said, of course, we have to try to inform people as much as we can, but not only people, yes, of course, because they vote, but also those who are elected by the votes of the people and who depend on the votes of the people and who sometimes use what they know, not necessarily in the way which is correct, to say the least. It's not deceptive.
Yeah, Barbara, I'd also like to say something. Of course, Jean-Marie is completely right. I mean, not every scientist is an outstanding speaker and can connect to the public. You know, and I think me as a scientist, I feel that the most important job is, first of all, of course, to train young students and then to get my results in my laser lab and to do that as rigorous as possible. And if I feel that I am not capable of communicating the critical aspects to the science, I have at least one obligation, and that is to become a member of one of our professional societies. You know, just think about the German Chemical Society, the American Physical Society, and you can always, bring in some initiative, and maybe someone in the society picks it up, some person who's more talented in reaching out to the public. So I think really this is what our scientific societies are good for, and therefore I can only encourage especially the younger people to engage in our communities, in our societies. They can help us.
Yeah, I've been, or still are, involved through German Physical Society, of course, in talking to the public. And I think for me as a scientist, and perhaps also for others, I think there is a few important criteria. Number one, from my point of view, is you have said this, we need to be truly professional for ourselves as the very first thing. And we need to be secured within our community that we are accepted as scientists. Yeah, we should, what Jean-Marie said, we should not talk about something we don't understand sufficiently well or so. Yeah, this is number one. So this is the basis. The second part is, in my view, you have to be really patient. We have to be really patient and we have to learn the language in doing this. And as Peter said, not everybody is the gifted scientist. I think it's useful, not only useful, it's also valuable to have this patience to go forward and forward. And then perhaps the third condition is you need to enjoy it to some extent. Otherwise, you will not be successful. If you hate it, as you mentioned for Levi-Strauss or so, then it won't work. But I think if you try it, you may find out, and I would appeal to also the younger ones or so, if you try it and find out it's something that you enjoy, then you should really do it. It helps the society.
So I want to go back to not talking. You should always talk about things you understand and stay away. I think this is very important. But in terms of the climate stuff, I've been working on a paper for 6 years. It's about to come out in PNAS. It's applied math statistics problem. But in doing that, I was also one of the co-authors is a very famous, the most published climate scientist. And lots of deep discussions about what's going on. And I think I was thinking, you don't have actually respectability until you publish significant works in that field, stick your neck out, get hammered by referees, all part of what you should do. And when I was Secretary of Energy, I hired a person, Steve Koonin, who is actually very skeptical about climate change. And we actually had no disagreements because we were both realized there were large uncertainties about what's going on. The uncertainties were understated by many people, especially the non-scientists. The serious climate scientists actually understand very well what they don't know and what they do know and things like that. And so in the since about 2000, I began to actually really read the literature and do this stuff, and I was realizing, and I went in skeptically. I said, is this really real? And by 2005 or 6, I said, there might be some truth to this. And by 2010, I said, no, it's understood enough. You know, we don't know, huge uncertainties of what might happen. In 2004, the fluctuations are huge.
The fluctuations of opinions are not too big anymore. They begin to...
Yeah, and there's more understanding. And there's more understanding, and there's more measurements, and so all of these things are coming, but then you can step back and say, even if it's only half right, the risk is so high that you might want to do something about it, and so it's a risk cost.
That's true, but also the cost is very high.
Cost is
enormous.
Very high.
So the question is, should one not put much more money into finding solutions rather than maybe chasing something which is important, but we don't know how to handle it?
I think premature aggressive deployment is going to waste a lot of money, and I'm very much against that.
Yeah, I agree.
So I don't think, and I'd spend a lot of my time doing, you know, I'm working on better batteries, and things like that, because if you make a much better, cheaper battery, it takes care of itself. Okay, and so I find that much more satisfying than being Secretary of Energy in a certain sense. Because if it works, it's going to work, and it's all about driving the cost down, so that you don't need policy to, you know, the world. Doesn't have the appetite for doubling energy prices, and we're seeing doubling energy prices in Europe.
So I think we should slowly come to an end. Thank you again, both of you, that you came to Bonn and celebrated Klausius's birthday with us. It was really an honor, and it was really very nice to have you here. Let's thank the speakers again. And I would also like to thank Dieter Meschete and Peter Föhringer. Come up. We have, you can give it to Dieter Meschete. He is at the end. Come. So we have a little bit to show our appreciation. But there's also one other person who was really great in organizing this event and who really took care of us. And I would like to thank Daniela Hüll. Please thank her all and her team. And again, the team of Daniela Hüll, we would like to thank. And Birgit Westernstür. And of course, the Rectorat for making it possible to have this nice event. Please thank them again. So, I think... Maybe that's... we have a reception outside in front of the Clausius Institute.